when was it? June 28th, 2001. Well, okay, no, that's when Gary and Montan joined. And then I joined on the 29th.
That's cool.
And I was...
Now I'm kind of curious, yeah.
I guess I was the fifth person to join on the 29th. And Alan was the second. So...
Very cool.
And of course, I had to tell Gary that I was, you know, now plotting to move up in the ranks. The turmoil between Grognards.
Yeah. That'll always be in effect.
Let's see here. Where can you see when your info is that here?
Oh, I have no idea. This is just something Gary posted in off topic in Cannon Fire.
Oh, he posted it on off topic. Okay.
Yeah, about 2:34 p.m. He posted a. Apparently, it's a list of the first 46 people, or the only screenshot of these are the first 46 who registered.
Yeah.
Awesome.
I noticed Razgun's on that list. Oof.
How about Rick? Is Rick on that list? Rick Miller?
I do not see Dewey Cartman on this person. A bunch of us joined on June 29th and then July 5th, 6th, 12th. No, I don't see Rick here. But I don't see Dewey Carthen here. Maybe using a... may have had another name, but I'm pretty sure he always used Dewey Carthen.
And you're like,
it wasn't anything big, but
crossing the void.
It was still, you know, something I wrote up and created.
The arc of time. Dwell those
that I, you
not
know,
of our place or age.
That I would actually break
it
out again.
Too easy to say that there is dark and there is light.
Well, let me see.
It is too easy to say
just
that
for
there
all
are two
time's
sides
sake.
To every coin. The reality is far worse.
Well, I hate, you know, not being able to find something, especially
chaos
when I need it, you know?
Freedom.
It drives me crazy. It's like, I need this, I need this, and I just can't find it, you know?
This isn't something I expect I'd ever need, but
for they know nothing.
For whatever reason, I think it might actually have a little Infernal more appeal.
And the Codex Exaltum.
Right.
Two like, source books.
I wrote up a Sacred Dance for Greyhawk.
Oh, cool.
From the farthest reaches of the heavens to the darkest.
But like I say, sadly, it is lost.
Both of these titles come with new, full color art,
stinks.
New creatures, new powers like possession, and a multitude of information providing lore, backgrounds, names.
Now, the Knife of Yak Taming, I'm sure nobody cares that that's lost.
These incredible tomes are filled with demons and angels.
That would drive me crazy if I like lost something permanent. And, like, good and evil, you know, it was a big deal.
Law and chaos on your
table. I can say it wasn't a big deal. It's just, you know.
And exalt them, bringing creatures hallowed and profane into your adventure.
It was something functional and creative.
That sounds cool.
Trollord Games, join the fray.
Okay, let's see here. We're getting close here. What time is it? Look, we got 10 minutes of. It's early still. Hey, Nikki. You want to go into this? This could be considered an obscure discussion tonight because we're going to do the southeast part of that area of the Flannis, and a lot of people do not adventure here. You know, it's a really cool area.
I think a lot of people do.
What's that?
I think a lot of people actually do.
Adventure here?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. At least from the interest I got in mapping the area, comments about it and stuff, so.
My guess is that people want areas that they don't normally go to max. That's why. But I could be wrong.
It's like rafting. You surprised me. There was so much interest in rafting. A lot of people like want for my campaign. They said, "Oh, when do you go on map rafting?"
Well, a lot of people like want. Len had a lot of interest in rafting too. Yeah, I appreciate. That, Nick. Thank you.
I can understand rafting. It's odd. I think people might be more interested in this area if some of the like little quirky bits were somewhat better stressed.
Quirky bits. What quirky bits?
Find out.
There you go. Yeah. No, I mean, other than Iron Gate, I think there's a lot of little quirks that can be inferred. And then there were more that were just completely thrown at it in Yell's Kid. Or, I'm not saying completely thrown at it, elaborated and thrown out there in the Yell's
Kid.
And I think, you know, maybe if you consider those a little more, they might think, oh, yeah, this area has a lot more potential.
Yep.
Sam,
I think it has huge potential, this area.
Sam,
you may want to
place your Iron Link notes into Anna's Discord, too.
Oh.
So she can have, yeah, she'll like that. Hey, Dave.
That means operating at the speed of slow.
It's okay.
Okay. Yeah.
And now, of course, I have to find where
it's good, though. It's really good.
Yeah.
I do it. You know what? No, I can't.
There you go.
Yeah, I'm going to shut down.
Oh, thank you.
I just sent them. There you go.
Awesome. Thanks.
Oh my gosh, I don't think
I got reminded of minor. You know, it's like, oh, that's
I think I did it. Yep, here, I did not update that.
When Jay messaged me, I mentioned to him I have had a couple of discussions with Gary, Stu, and Paul. I guess maybe 2 months ago now, when I started writing my Central Planet Gaz, and I got to Nyron, and I started considering some Great Kingdom issues. So I had gone over this stuff, but I like, you know what, let me refresh everything.
Yes.
And of course, for me, it helps having a timeline to look at with the highlights.
It's cool.
So I very rapidly just made a timeline with a couple of extra notes.
We are early, which is good. I curse myself. I'm way ahead of schedule tonight. I don't know how.
That's good.
Yeah. This is 4 streams in 5 days. Wednesday night, Thursday night, Saturday morning, Sunday night. Yep, this is a 4 and 5. And then I'm off for until a week from Sunday because of work. Be away. Well, there's no reason why. I'm glad we're doing this tonight because there won't be one next week. Because I'll be in Vegas. But coming live a little early, everyone. I know it's really early start. So, hey. I sound like Dwayne from What's Happening just now. hey. Yeah. How's everyone doing? I got with me Anna and Sam Weiss tonight.
Hello.
For a great discussion on an area that I ignore completely.
Mm-hmm. Completely,
but it's got a, it's rich in lore and it's rich in ideas. And I don't know how much I'll be supplying tonight. I have one piece of artwork from one of our friends who really loves the area, like loves Greyhawk and has done one. So I have a picture of Sunndi, believe it or not, in art. But that'll be about the limit of my sharing of things. So, of course there, Courtney, no problem. So, Sam, I asked you to come on here because I know you've been doing some stuff, which is great. What's this project you're working on?
Oh, well, after I finished some of my other projects, it just hit me to start reviewing the Central Flanaise. Yeah, looking over stuff for Furiundi, looking over stuff for Nyron, looking over stuff for the Northern Reaches, including defining them, whatever the heck they are. And since I'm doing east, west, and north, looking south, and doing the Celentan. So I did my own little gazetteer of the Central Flanaise.
Cool.
And sort of an extension of that, when I was trying to go through some Nyron stuff, it happened that I had to, oh, let me look at some Great Kingdom stuff. Let me look, of course, when Nyron is in the Golden League. Any references, you know, Iron League stuff came up. And then there's a couple of confusing entries in from the Ashes.
Of course.
So I had to pester Gary, Paul, and Stu until, you know, and then of course they tell you, no, it's right there. Where is it? And they, of course, nobody can remember where they made this up. And I finally found it by reading in detail the LGG entries.
Okay.
Which then, oh, that clears it up.
So they made corrections to what was going on and from the Ashes a bit in the LGG.
Well, oh, so, yeah. Yeah, definitely. I guess every subsequent publication, usually they cleaned up a lot of the inconsistencies and smooth out some of the stuff from early on. But they also sometimes introduce new inconsistencies at times too. But usually I prefer to go to the later sources because they have a good summary and good detail on the previous ones. And often they elaborate on the previous ones. So you, yes, by going early, you miss out stuff. So yeah. Living Greyhawk Gazetteer is my go-to. I start there, so to speak, but then I read the box set for and from the Ashes just to kind of see, okay, what was said originally about this, so I make sure that, right, I don't screw up, so to speak. But Living Greyhawk is my go-to, yeah, by far, because it's the most complete one.
In this case, the LGG really clarified. I mean, the statement was rather simple. Carl just had the Herzog of the South Province joined with the rebels of the Iron League, mm-hmm, against Ivid when he began the turmoil between crowns. And that statement just doesn't make sense.
Okay.
Because we know later that when the Iron League actually formed, they sent representatives to the Herzog of South Province who had them ritually tortured for the Overking's amusement. Mm-hmm. Like, wait, they went to their ally and he tortured them? No. But then it clarifies it in the LGG. Basically, yes, when the turmoil between crowns began, all of the South Province rebelled, including the Herzog. Mm-hmm. Then after Ivan had won, one of the first things he did was replace the Herzog, who was a Crandon, with one of his cousins, who was a Nalex. And in fact, I actually have the name up here. I made a note of it. It was Herzog Galsonin of Crandon.
Right.
And he was replaced by Damalinor of Nalex. And he is the one when the Lord Mayor of Irongate, you know, headed a delegation. It was Damalinor of Nalex who took him and had him tortured for Ivid's amusement.
It's like Ividian or Nalex diplomacy, so to speak.
Their sense of humor. Mm-hmm.
Well, they torture their allies if they're not allied enough, so to speak.
But yeah, that finally explained that. Otherwise, like, wait, what does this mean that Sergeant wrote? That doesn't make sense. Like, oh, mm-hmm. Okay. Nope, they cleared it up in the LGG.
Yep.
Well, that's good to hear that you got some corrections here. And this is great. This is a great timeline. So, but like, where do we start? And that's the thing. Yeah. Oh, well, thank you. So, Anna, we just got a follow from some call me Tim 19 and it has nothing to do with the ever mysterious Tim. They call me Tim, which is really funny.
Wow.
So we got another Tim joining the group. We got Enoch Pratt awesome. Tim. We got Sir Timothy. They call me Tim, the ever mysterious Tim. And now some
awesome.
Call me
Welcome.
Tim.
Wow. Yeah.
So yeah, that's pretty funny. So, all right. And welcome. Welcome to live. I know YouTube's a great place, but live, you get some interactivity. And we're starting an hour an hour earlier than normal. People will be still rolling in to view here. So if we go on the Grand Greyhawk map here, Anna's map, and we
let's start with the geography first, so we kind of define what area we're talking about and stuff. So yeah, it's the southeastern corner of mainland Flannies, so to speak. The bit there, and that it has some really really interesting geography.
It does.
Yeah. It's some ways it's the most interesting target-rich geography of the whole of the Flannies in a lot of sense, because it has lots of cool stuff, and it has stuff that exist on Earth but is very rare on Earth. It has one of these, and it has one of these rivers that don't reach the sea, and there are a couple of examples in the real world of rivers that don't reach the sea, and one famous one is the River Jordan in Israel, Palestine, Jordan, so to speak, that go from one lake down to a lower lane lake and dissipates in there. And another one that is much bigger that is in Africa, it's called Okavango, and that simply starts up in the mountains and then have a delta and evaporates in a desert, so to speak.
Wow.
It's a very famous in South Africa in the Namibian desert. There's a huge river delta that is just out in the flats, so to speak, that a river just dissipates, a major river that just ends out, but because the climate is so warm. And here we have two rivers that ends in nowhere, so to speak, in the Sunndi Basin. And one is from the North Pollock, and then we have the from the south, you have the Gov River, and they form the vast swamp, so to speak. That's the lowest laying feature in that basin. But there ought to be a little bit of kind of, my guess is that these mountains are probably some holes in them. So I assume that the vast swamp is probably at sea level, and there's a little bit of leak, because otherwise it depends on how humid it is. But the good thing is that means that what should have been a desert bowl, because this is subtropic area, so vast swamp is where desert should be. And if you have a bowl that is surrounded by mountains, it tends to be very dry, and it therefore tends to become a desert hellhole, so to speak, a little bit like the Sea of Dust is. But this one has a couple of things speaking for it. First of all, it's fairly small. The mountains aren't as tall, and it has some warm oceans on the side. So it's not land on the side, it's water. And that means that it probably traps some moisture, and that falls as rain inside the bowl and stays there. And therefore you have like probably some really, really good agriculture, because it's like a subtropic, nice, warm, rainy, and you get a very, very, very decent climate. Hot but humid, but not too hot, so to speak. Mm. It's so in that sense, it kind of makes sense that you have there is a lot of maybe a lot of the forest, and originally might have been forest, the whole shebang might have been forest, and then over time a lot of elves and humans and stuff live there and cut some of it down, and now we only have partial forest.
So is it like in like there's a huge lake in Death Valley right now, right? Because of all the overflow of water.
Yeah.
If it kept on overflowing for like 10, 20 years.
Oh, could... yeah. But the Death Valley. The Dead Sea is under sea, they're below sea level. But there's another kind of, below sea level. But it's also a little bit away from, it's not far away from the oceans, but it's warm. It's, I would say, It's very dry air, so to speak.
Right.
This should be so we have to simply assume that there's a little bit more favorable winds here that brings more moisture in. We just have to, since it's a fantasy world and we know what the land looked like, that we need to.
Okay.
It should be drier and much more of a desert hole than it is, so to speak. So we have to kind of tweak the climate a little bit to suit the stories, because the stories talk about marshlands, forests, and lots of stuff like that, not deserts or dry land and stuff. So there is nothing in the text as far as I know. So we have to tweak and play with the weather a little bit and play with the climate.
Okay. I would point at, well, three things.
Yeah.
One, you mentioned holes in the hills. The highlands are...
They're called the Hollow Highlands.
Right. They're not right on the vast swamp, but they're there.
Oh, yeah. They need to be, because otherwise the river would go somewhere else. That's why I simply assumed that, because the river flows... It doesn't go into the ocean anywhere. It flows into from both sides. So that means that there needs to be some highlands. And I made them kind of low hills just so they're there, because they're not really on the map, but they're there just to make the sense of, because we know where the rivers flow. So I just needed to elevate the geography so it matches where the rivers are actually flowing on the maps we have.
Right. Yeah. And the thing is, if they're that hollow, maybe there are passages through to the ocean.
Yeah, exactly. And that keeps the vast swamp leveled, so to speak, because if there's too much water, then it will sink down to sea level. But if it's too little, then it will come in, so to speak. So that maintains a natural amount of humidity inside the bowl, which is really, really good, because then it can evaporate in. And that can kind of explain why you have a very humid subtropics rather than a dry, deserty subtropics.
And then the next thing I would know, again, based on your, extending from your comment about there having been forest at one time, there is the Menno wood.
Yeah, exactly. There are woods in many, many places. And that's why I made the area lots of little forests here and there and everywhere. So,
well, in this case, I mean, the Menno wood directly touches on the northwest corner of the vast swamp.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep.
And then goes all the way to the sea.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I can imagine that lots of parts of the vast swamp are probably forested too. So it's not just open. It's probably a lot of like mangroves and little patches with forest and then just open water and a mixture of all of it. So
this is the shame where Gaetano hasn't been around for a long time, because this is his like wheelhouse, right? He has an entire campaign setting down here. It's unfortunate, because that's his babies, the Tomb of Horrors and the surrounding lands.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's the third thing I was about to bring up. The 800-pound gorilla to easily hand wave almost any explanation you need for the vast swamp is Acererac.
Yeah, exactly. We can kind of play with it. But and you can kind of, you can introduce as much magic and interaction like that if you want in your campaign. I'm just giving, there are other options too you can play with. So
he built his tomb and he wanted it isolated, so he closed up whatever.
Yeah, and it's probably a good, go on.
Yeah, yeah, he closed up one or two outlets, maybe two, one to each sea.
Yeah.
And there's your vast swamp.
Yeah. And it is one of the really isolated areas, because you have like hills around it and water and stuff. So it's, in many ways, it's doubly isolated in some sense. And Sunndi is also landlocked in weird ways. It's
yes,
close to water on many sides, but it's landlocked. Oh. And it's kind of it's interesting in that sense. It has coastline, okay, but doesn't seem to have done anything with it.
Yeah. Obscure reference, you know, easy to overlook. I believe it's in one of those dragon articles I linked you.
Okay. Which
that Sunndi has had to deal with sea baron raids.
Mm-hmm. So they have abandoned the coast maybe because it's too dangerous. Yeah.
Well, I don't think they've abandoned it, but I think they even though the other maps usually show it completely within the bowl and Dahlstrand is completely independent,
yeah,
I think Sunndi does have territory on the coast there.
Oh, yeah. I put the bit from the north of Dahlstrand all the way up to the, yeah, along the Hestmark Eastern Ridge. I put that under Sunndi that they actually... That's their coastline.
The well, it must be the other.
Yeah,
but
it's kind of a harsh, kind of cliffy coastline, so it's not very habitable. But there are plenty of natural ports. And in my campaign, I'm thinking about Sunndi actually making some. But they have to deal with a lot of hostile forces over the water, so to speak, from Elisen, you know, and to Scarlet Brotherhood and others. So yeah.
Yeah, page 15 or 16.
Yeah, it's page 15 on both, which is really weird.
Yeah. Oh, I think you went way too far.
Yeah, I did. I did. I got enticed. I got enticed by the... All right, there's the barbarian. I got enticed by the bandit in here.
Yeah.
One of my favorites.
57 has the entry for South Province, which, you know...
There's Rift Canyon. That's Rift Canyon. Here it is. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. And then this has all the individual... this has Medegia... And the individual
Sea Barons or Province. So is it under Sea Barons or is it under Sunndi?
I believe it would be under Sunndi.
Yeah, Sea Barons is way up north, so that's another part
of
the world.
Though.
Oh no, but they're included in this
Oh, okay, in that news update, so to speak.
Yeah. Okay.
Here it is documented. I'm just scanning through it here.
Yeah, we have South Province and Sunndi and yeah.
That's the thing. Going through these is difficult, everyone. So just note, you know, these.
Yeah, they're a little bit, and they're like wargaming reports.
They are
because
absolutely.
We have to remember this is from the wargaming roots, so shining through. So there's a lot of like troop movements and numbers and stuff like that. So because these are from an era where the wargaming was still in a dominant force in the role players was still in a lot of cases since still wargamers.
Oh no, Sunndi is in 57.
Okay, I went
Sunndi is on page 16 here, I think.
Right. The first two
start
lines 15, are on page 15,
yeah.
And then
exactly, and then on 16. So yeah. And this is cool because this is part of Gary's.
Why don't I see Sunndi?
Because it's right before Iron Gate and ID. It's literally
it starts at the bottom at the end of page.
Oh, there it is. Ah, I can't find anything.
Yep.
All right, I got it. So,
yep.
Maybe
so these are really good. And
all right, let's talk about that. While I send a message to my son, these pop ups from Xbox are killing me.
Yeah. Yeah, Sam, go on.
Go for it. Yeah, please, Sam.
Oh, no. I mean, that's it. It's okay. So, another thing. Okay. Count Hazendell alerted his liegemen in the Ruwood and Gloriel's Hestmarks. Mm-hmm. So, right there, we can see the Gloriel's Hestmark is that Sunndi does include a significant part of those hills and mountains to the east, which, you know, is where you get the coastline.
Yeah.
And there's...
But there's no settlements mentioned. No cities, no towns.
Because it's
no
all elven. Right. Isn't Sunndi a gray elven?
Partly, yeah. It's,
yeah,
it's...
It has apparently a gray elven ruler.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And this is explained, I suppose you would say, in the Living Greyhawk gazetteer.
Yep.
Ah, okay. Excellent. Hey, Guardman. Sunndi, XD? Sunndi? I like Sunndi. Because I got my South Jersey accent and hack everything apart. So, what's up, Jeff? You know, it's all good. However you pronounce things, you know, like I said, I butcher everything.
Yeah.
It is in the world of Greyhawk. Let's see. It is threatened continually, however, from the north by the Herzog's legions, from the east by the forces of the Holy Center of Medegia, and by the sea barons along its coasts.
Mm-hmm. The good thing is that Ivy took care of Medegia, at least.
Yeah.
Yep.
But like I say, there is a reference that it does have a coastline that is attacked by...
Yeah.
By the sea barons.
Yeah, and it doesn't sound like, if you look at this last paragraph here, if the censor Medegia would choose this time to invade, this is pre-wars, right? The county itself would be hard-pressed.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
This must be around 576-ish.
Sunndi militia numbering
about
6,000 can be raised. There are foresters and several thousand elves of the rearward. So basically, it is a lot of human. Hillmen, gnomes, and dwarves dwelling in the
Greyhawk. There's plenty of humans.
Mix.
Yeah, Sunndi is, in that sense, ripe for adventuring because you can put together a party made up of almost anything. Because you have dwarves in the glorioles and humans and elves, and you can probably find some gnomes and halflings here somewhere too. So you can put together, it's a very diverse area in that sense.
So where were, so just answer me this, all this area. Yeah. Dahlstrand and all. Was it under Sunndi before? Was it an independent city?
Well, my guess, we don't know much about Dahlstrand. And Samwise, please correct me afterwards. My theory on this is that Dahlstrand was one area that was in one time or another, either allied with Great Kingdom when Sunndi was not, or vice versa. So therefore it's separate, so to speak. So Sunndi and Dahlstrand have some sort of different history with the Great Kingdom, because they were probably not conquered together and they were not allied together, so to speak. One way or the other, they had a political differences, and that was probably due to their relations with the Great Kingdom. So therefore, Dahlstrand stayed, is now not a part of Great Kingdoms. That's my theory. Samwise, do you have any real knowledge of this?
Yes and no.
Okay. Yeah.
I have the extremely sketchy knowledge that I gleaned from reading through everything. So,
why don't we do that? Why don't we go through your knowledge of this? Because I'm assuming this is basically your outline, right?
Yeah, this is my outline. Okay. So first off, the Iron League is the county of Sunndi, the county of Eide, and the Free League of Iron Gate.
Okay.
No, I have that wrong.
Free City,
It is the County of Iron Eide, the Jacobon Wall, and the Free City of Iron Gate.
Okay.
It was later joined by the Lord of Duxton, the Lordship of the Isles, and then after that by the County of Sunndi, which is now the Kingdom of Sunndi. Mm-hmm. Although they're not listed as independent kingdoms, the Glorioles, the Hestmark Highlands, the Hollow Highlands, and the Iron Hills are all effectively part of the Iron League.
Okay.
Either as direct vassals or, I mean, the Iron Hills is noted as having its own king, Holgi Iron Fist.
Yeah.
Alyssa was, all of these were part of the South Province.
Right.
Alyssa was part of the South Province, and it's difficult to parse out. I didn't include the note here, but there are Herzogal lands that are, like, separate from Alyssa, that are also part of South Province. So, Eide Onwall, Iron Gate, Lordship of the Isles, Sunndi, and Alyssa constitute South Province along with the lands of the ruling family.
This is pre-Greyhawk Wars, pre-Ivy the Undying.
Oh, yeah.
Correct. Mm-hmm.
Got it.
And technically, it's even pre those two issues of Dragon.
Okay.
Those two issues of Dragon introduce the Golden League, which includes the Kingdom of Nyrhon and the Prelacy of Almor.
Did not know that. That's
yes,
in the. They're mentioned in those articles, but that's the only place they're mentioned. Correct.
Correct.
Okay.
Oh no, they get mentioned in later sources.
Okay.
They get mentioned in Greyhawk Wars, in
Golden League. Okay.
FBA because of that, and in the Living Greyhawk Gazetteer.
Okay.
Okay, so even though it's, I have some other things here. The first real date we get for this, for the Iron League, is -46 CY when Onwall is conquered.
Okay.
That's the first hard date. But as part of that, it notes that this was mostly a Flan area. It was conquered. And in the century before, the Sewell of Alyssa, Alyssa was a Flan kingdom. Onwall, Idy, and Sunndi were occupied by Sewell, and Idy and Sunndi had been conquered before. Alyssa had been conquered at the start of the period, Idy and Sunndi later on, and then Onwall was apparently the last conquered in -46.
Okay, so was Alyssa called Neri back then, and then called Neri a second? I got it all confused.
Idy first, and then became Neri, and not Alyssa. Right. It was was Idy, and then Idy was renamed to Neri.
But I thought Alyssa was Neri before too.
No. In the beginning, it's okay. They don't have names. They're just called that because that's where it is.
Okay, got it.
Well, it was probably called the Headlands. Sunndi was probably might have been called Pawlock, and Idy doesn't have a name.
Okay.
They received names later. Mm-hmm. So okay. Alyssa had been the land of Queen Alyssa with the marvelous nightingale.
Exactly. Yep.
There was apparently Sulawese in Idy, Sunndi, and Onwall, and in Sunndi the Sulawese had made alliances with the elves. Okay. But the Great Kingdom conquered them all. The Kingdom of Erdi conquered them all.
Except Iron Gate. They didn't conquer Iron Gate, correct?
They didn't have to. Iron Gate does not exist yet.
Really? Oh, it says Iron Gate completed, 124. Okay.
Yep. Okay, now the Battle of Fortnite's Length, there is a note in Sunndi, and I just put in -100 CY as a placeholder. In Sunndi, it says that Sunndi was made part of South Province after the Battle of Fortnite's Length.
Okay. Wow.
Okay. Right. So all of this is now part of the South Province. 1 CY, the Kingdom of Erdi becomes the Great Kingdom. In 12, Scant is completed.
Okay.
In 102 to 103, House Atir wins a contest against House Torquan.
For Asperdi Isles.
For the Asperdi Isles, the Sea Barons.
Right.
And he becomes Admiral of the Great Kingdom.
Okay.
Okay, this will become important in a little bit. In 124, Iron Gate has been completed.
124. I'm just showing where Asperity Isle is. It's way up here.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now in 166, the Overking got tired of raids coming from the Dutchchen Islands and told his admiral to go conquer it.
Okay.
Now, I don't know it here, but in 167, I think it is when Dalstrand is built by Baron Atir of Asperdi. Admiral Atir of Asperdi.
Builds Dalstrand.
And the next year, he conquers the Dutchchen Islands.
Okay. So he uses this as a port to leave from, basically.
Yep. A forward base to assault. Now, this we can imply that House Atir were also the rulers of the Dutchchen Islands.
Okay. They're not close. No,
Dutchchen is down south.
It's
the Lordship of the Isles.
Part of Lordship
of the Isles. Yeah.
Okay, now, well, this
is one of the islands there. Yeah.
Another thing we might know is that geologically, it should be that the Asperdi Islands to the Spindrifts to the Dutchchen are a single archipelago.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that then leads to the question is, what efforts did Atir and the Sea Barons make to conquer the Spindrift Isles?
Right. Hmm.
But they never did.
But Len was there, so it never happened.
Right. Okay, so nothing really happens in this area for around 300 years until 437 when the turmoil between the crowns happens. Okay, technically something does happen to House Atir. They become Herzogs of North Province, replacing House Nalax. And for like 100 years or so. And then House Nalax arranges to eliminate them and buy it back.
I'm surprised that they buy something that they didn't just conquer it. But that, seen as a terrible mismanagement of funds in the Nalax. Yeah.
I don't include it here. I have it in another file somewhere. But apparently at this time, when the Overking died, the next one had to pay massive amounts of bribes to become Overking.
Okay. Well,
and yeah. So he was in a ton of debt. And one of the two of the things he did, one, he took the Sea of Medegia from the Fultons and gave it to the Zilchins, who, of course, were bankrolling him. And the other thing is he sold North Province back to House Nalax because he needed money.
That's a big ticket item there.
Mm-hmm. It is. And this is, okay, hypothetically, House Atir went extinct. I mean, there's some things that suggest it's extinct, others that it's not quite.
Well, there's a lot of small places up there that they can still rule that but they're subservient to the Neelix, that's
well,
for sure.
Well, but the thing is, I suspect they still do rule the Sea Barons. And I would suspect they still rule the Lordship of the Isles.
Yeah, so in that sense, they are more or less independent. So in that sense, they are, yeah.
Well, yeah, over this time, they're becoming more and more independent.
Yeah.
Okay, so the turmoil between the crowns starts. And like I say, I don't include this directly in the timeline. It's in notes elsewhere. At this time, all of South Province is in revolt,
yeah.
including the Crandon Herzog, whose name is, yeah, there it is, Herzog Galsonin, is allied with all
what,
the
what year are we talking about now? Yeah.
437 to 446.
Okay, thank you. Yep. Mm-hmm.
All the South Province is supporting the House Rax against House Nalax.
Yep.
446 rolls around, or at least 445 rolls around. Ibid the first wins. And one of the first things he does is he replaces Galsonin of Crandon with Damalin or of Nalax.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the first things the still rebelling South does is the mayor of Irongate goes to the Herzog and says, "We're not gonna stand for this. This is ridiculous. We don't like it." And that's where he gets tortured. And Irongate and ID and Onwall form the Iron League.
Okay.
There is a okay. The right away Iron the Iron League Irongate kicks the Herzog, the new Herzog, out of the Iron Hills.
So, bro.
And then the Herzog responds by massing 1,000 banners and sieges Irongate. In 448, Duxchan, the Lordship of the Isle, says, you know what? We're formally joining the Iron League. Now, no date is given, but there is a rebellion of Sunndi at this time. And they beat up all the people, you know, all the Erdi rulers, and kick them out. And in 455, Sunndi joins the Iron League.
Nice.
Which might seem a bit odd. It's like, really? They hadn't been from the beginning. No, apparently they didn't join. They were more firmly controlled by South Province, it would seem. And it was Esparathen, the first count of Sunndi. He was a gray elf, and apparently he had led the rebellion. This is from the LGG. He'd been a strong leader of the rebellion, and all the humans said, you know what? We'll go with you. We like you.
Thanks, Moose, for kicking that up.
Yeah, he's the first elf to come in and get in charge. There's no firm date, but in the 550s, the Chellors are appointed Herzogs of South Province. And apparently there will be three Chellors before, you know, they mess up.
Yeah, that's a name I don't know. Where's that? Is that a family name?
No, Chellor is the personal name. They are Nalaxes.
Yep.
Oh, okay.
Well, they are said to be Nalax Selor, S-E-L-O-R. So like the Selor clan of the Nalax family.
Yeah, they're like a family or something of the, yeah. Mm-hmm. But they're part of the Nalax noble house. So there's one family
lineage
in there. Yeah.
So you're saying that when the box set comes out, this is where the Rob Kuntz articles are. That's why you say 577 Herzog Chellor evade Sunndi, because that's what's
yes.
in
what articles are you talking
yes.
about?
Yep.
Dragon 57 and 63.
Yes.
They are set in just after 576. So, yeah. Because the articles describe the changes from the box set.
Right. 564, this is an LGG reference. They say that there was some question about the succession in the Lordship of the Isles, and Latmac Ranald eventually won out. And this may be when House Atyr gets replaced in the Lordship of the Isles. We're not sure. Yeah. Latmac Ranald wants to be way more aggressive, and he eventually provokes the Battle of Medegia with the Sea Barons, between Asperdi and Duxchin. And like I say, this may still be mostly a cousin war. This may be all...
It might be the worst. Yeah, family is...
You know, ratified within House Atyr. But the Lordship loses. They lose four cogs before they make it into Pontlivre. And of course, that's its own little note. They got to refuge in Pontlivre. Even though Pontlivre's in Medegia, and technically they're at war with them.
Wow.
The next year is the date given for when the Scarlet Brotherhood begins infiltrating the Iron League.
Oh, that pains me. But it's on the side of the map, so I don't care.
Okay, yeah, well, it's a relevant date that, you know, if you're going past this point. Actually, I think even that's even noted in the folio and box set itself, that representatives showed up. Whether or not they infiltrate this much, that's up to you.
Yeah.
576, that's the start. 577, Chelor invades Sunndi. This is from one of those articles. 579, the Golden League is formed. Expansion, this is the expansion of the Golden League. Ivid manages, not a victory, but you know, at least diplomatically, he keeps the Golden League from expanding further. You know, they don't subvert, I don't know who, they don't subvert the Sea Barons or Drax in Ralastra and get in, or they don't get Ratic to join the Golden League. Now we're getting into Greyhawk Wars. 583, the Gloriole's army of it's Medegia or South Province, I forget which, conquers Sunndi.
Huh.
Later in 583, Asin of Almor liberates Sunndi. 583 to 584 is the Scarlet Brotherhood coup during the winter months, seizing the Duxchins, Eidi, and Anwu.
This is intricate Game of Thrones stuff. So I like it.
Yeah.
Oh, 584 is the start from the Ashes. And the little note there, 141 years, is also a note for the folio box set start. That's how many years the Iron League has been in existence.
Okay.
584 to 586, there's another siege of Iron Gate because, you know, the Scarlet Brotherhood wants to conquer it. 584, the Duxchin Lord is raiding Gradsil.
That's Scarlet Brotherhood people.
Right, at the behest of the Scarlet Brotherhood. 586, the Onwall Revolt begins. Later in 586, the United Kingdom of Alyssa has formed and conquered Eidi, at which point it is renamed Neri. 589, Sunndi declares itself, the Alvin Steward declares himself king instead of just the Count and Alvin Steward. 590, the Lordship is at full at war with any free people on the Azure Sea. Also in 590, the mayor of Iron Gate recognizes Gion Destron, who's leading the rebel of Iron Gate? No, that should be of Onwall. Recognizes Gion Destron leading the rebellion in Onwall.
Okay.
590 is the first official meeting of the Sunndi court. And, you know, the new king is like, nope, everyone gets to be a count. And we're really showing we're a united country. However, there are Wastrian raids from the vast swamp.
See, I like that.
591, the LGG has started. It's now been 148 years. There's a note that ships from Alyssa have been seen in Gradsil. And so Alyssa and Keeland are apparently competing.
Where is that? Is that in LGG?
Yes, it is. That would be an LGG reference.
It's got to be Gary's doing, right?
I don't know who wrote Alyssa.
Oh, okay. So it's not Keeland. It's not the Keeland section. It's in the Alyssa section.
Interesting. I think it might be in the Sea Princess. Lordship of the Isles setting. I don't recall.
Okay.
And then if we're going by the usual, you know, add a year, it is now 614 CY and it's been 171 years.
Okay.
Now, a couple of notes. This was, like maybe 6 months ago, we had a discussion trying to figure out those obscure references to what, you know, the Great Kingdom after the Battle of the Fortnight's Length ruled from the Telfet Gulf to the Sea of Yar. And we kind of, after studying the map and me doing some other research and finding references, the Telfet Gulf is the little bight by the plug to the Tilvanel Peninsula. That, yeah, that little bay there, the gulf, you know, where the vast swamp is going to the south.
Right here?
And let me look. Yes. That is the Telfet.
Okay.
I mean, it's the only thing that makes sense.
Right.
And then the Sea of Yar is that section of the sea off the coast of Eidi.
Okay.
Around to Iron Gate. Eidi to Iron Gate. That would be
this?
Yes. This is yep, that area in there is the Sea of Yar.
How do you spell Yar?
Y-A-R.
I guess because there's an isle out here, and it's because it's a different flow of, you know, different tide.
Thank you. Awesome.
The thing is, I did look, you know, for example, like the Mediterranean, the coast off of France is a different sea. It is part of the Mediterranean, but it's also its own little sea.
Right, right.
Mm-hmm.
So it is possible. It doesn't have to be enclosed. It could be part of a greater sea. And then because from there, go, you know, from the Telfet Gulf to the Sea of Yar, to the Woolly Bay. And well, that's, you know, yeah, we're going from there, from the Sea of Yar, we go to the Sea of Girnat, to the Woolly Bay.
Yeah, okay.
And that way we just kind of brainstormed and argued, and that was what we came up with.
It's gotta be there, yeah.
Now, Sergeant has a Duke Coriel, and I have no idea who this guy is, and he mentions him twice in From the Ashes. First, he escapes with militia from Eidi, but then later he's a Duke of Anwal. And there shouldn't be a Duke in Anwal because a Zhek is a very low-ranking title. And so is a Count. So I have no idea who Duke Coriel is. He's someone Sergeant introduced, unless someone else has a better reference for him. Like I say, I found Asparathan, the first Count of Sunndi, and Holgi Hirsut, King of the Iron Hills. He appears in one of those Dragon articles. And apparently there was a split because the Count of Eidi said the dwarves marched slowly because Holgi's beard was too long. And so then Holgi wasn't going to show up to defend them the next year until the Count apologized. Which then, of course, leads into Greyhawk Wars and Alyssa swarming in and conquering Eidi.
Right.
Or, you know, getting ready to, but then, you know, they defeat the Eidi army and then, oh, look, the Scarlet Brotherhood shows up and stages a coup and takes over. Uh-huh.
That's painful. It just gives me agita.
And that
I like
is,
Alyssa better.
That is the extent of canon dates and references.
Okay. Interesting. That's awesome, man. That's a deep dive, dude. That is super deep,
that's
and that is like awesome because it's definitely.
You know, as we said, honestly, I think with all that information, there's like 40 campaigns waiting to be written there.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And played out and stuff. Yep, definitely. You know?
There's plenty of stuff going on during every era of publication.
Yes.
You know, and that's the thing that you can really run. You can run an old school 576 there with the Iron League, you know. So, hey, Patrick, thank you, man.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. And the thing is, you can run a court one where the Scarlet Brotherhood is infiltrating. You could run one where you can run another court one where you're trying to get the Count to apologize to the Dwarf King.
Mm-hmm.
You can run more court stuff where you're trying to get more aid from Nyrond, from the Golden League.
Yep.
Mm.
And then there's so many military campaigns there. There's so many there's just nasty hunting in the vast swamp and Menowood.
No, it's great. It's fantastic that showing. So from that, we can really delve into like some of the lands here and what's going on in the surrounding areas and some more ideas in specific. Because this, you know, it's really not a large area. I mean, probably from South Province down to the vast swamp is not even the size of the Great Kingdom area, landmass wise, right? Not even close. So it's not a large area, right? But you got a ton of different, you got different factions, races, political agendas. You know, you got sea-based campaigns. You could do an entire campaign setting here in the Tomb of Horrors if you want. So there's a lot of really cool stuff. So, fantastic, Sam, on that deep dive into the that's great, man. I don't have the stick with itness to delve into those little details and build up that.
Well, it's you might not need it for your campaign.
Well, yeah,
it depends on what type of games you want to run.
Yeah, absolutely. But it's great that someone like Sam's doing it. So,
yep.
So solid commercial roads east-west through Sunndi. I doubt it.
No, Sunndi is very isolated.
There are some.
Yeah, but it's interesting. Sunndi actually only has one decent.
It looks like two.
One decent road going in and out, and that's actually going north towards Karlstrand and stuff. So you can go from Pitchfield to Karlstrand. That's the only one that I've taken that have decent quality, and
except George,
meaning that goes between countries that are not hostile but very distrustful,
right,
towards each other. But it was probably essential during the time when it was the Overkings that created it, when they ruled it as a province, they needed it, so to speak. So that's the only major thoroughfare between the two that I kind of put in my, and then you have a couple of small ones. There is one west going towards Zeldradon and then in that way out.
Yeah, by the way, Ben Cameron says he's got a campaign going on right now in this area.
Yeah. Oh, cool. Awesome. Yeah. And then there's some. There's several minor ones, so to speak, that are lesser quality and not that easy. But so but if you want to go on foot and have your horse with you, there's many places you can cut across, so to speak. But they will be not major trade routes. There's only one I have that way.
So, Sunndi is noted for having trade east and west.
Yeah. But it's kind of interesting that terrain doesn't seem to apply to it. But we can kind of tweak it, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But what I would suggest is a low road under the Rue-Wood from the Glorials to the Hollow Highlands, and then maybe another one under that gap to Idy into the Iron Hills.
Okay.
Because you've got dwarves here, and like, the Hollow Highlands are hollow because they've been hollowed out by all the dwarven tunneling.
Okay.
So you're saying roll it through this area up here.
We have one through Adderstone. Well, there's one documented from Newkeep to Nary City.
I was going
to
say.
There's one road. Yeah.
I'm saying an under-earth road.
Okay.
Like a low road, like the low road of the Lort Mills, you're saying?
Like the low road of the Lort Mills. A low road from the Hollow Highlands to the Glorials. And, you know, another spur extending into the Iron Hills.
That's a long way, man.
It is. It isn't. I mean, it's... Okay.
It's hundreds of miles underlay. It's long.
Okay, from the very tip of the Glorials to the very northern tip of the Hollow Highlands is about four hexes of clear.
Yeah.
So we'll add a little bit on each side and say 150 miles.
That's very long underground. It's very long.
Well, for new construction,
standards.
If it's not ancient already, they're there.
Well, whenever you dig it, it's to dig it is a major undertaking.
So, how long are those tunnels in Vault of the Drow?
But
there's the other explanation. They might be natural caves. That will be the most obvious ones. Meaning
right, so, and that's what I mean. When I say low road, I don't mean, you know, a road just fully newly carved. I just mean natural tunnels connected.
Yeah, okay. Fair enough.
That the dwarves use to get around underground because, you know, they don't want to deal with people.
So Troy says the Devil's Dung module that Len wrote was placed in ID close to the Hollow Highlands. So Devil's Dung is in this area here, which is cool. So here's my thought. Like, we have Doors of Iron Gate, right? And we have Doors of the Iron Hills, and they don't seem to be, like, they may be allied with each other, but they're not this, you know, they're not like family, correct? Correct with that?
Nothing says they're family. How much relations with the Kingdom of the Iron Hills with Iron Gate with the Headlands?
Right, but my point is that maybe the Iron Hills, the Hollow Hills dwarves, and the Glory Hills dwarves are not, right? Hey, Amy, good to see you. Are not all super allied together either. Maybe they got their own agendas too. I there's a lot of dwarves tend to be that way. I haven't seen you in a while, Amy. It's good to see you. It's cool.
Well, I did my own alternative take.
That's good.
On the dwarves of the region, and decided that the dwarves here, rather than being primarily family oriented, they are politically united, but they do have their king. They have King Holgi, who is their candidate to be High King of the Dwarves, even though he hasn't found the Axe of the Dwarvish Lords yet. Instead, they're primarily ruled by their by the scholars that head their guilds, the research scientists, the research scholars of the various guilds. And that is the true source of the conflict. When the Count of Idy insulted Holgi, it's not that he was insulting Holgi. He was insulting the people, the dwarven experts who decide how long the dwarven king's beard should be, what style it should be. You know, the experts who decide how fast the dwarves should march, what their logistics are. He insulted like a dozen different guilds. And they're the ones who told the king, well, we're not helping him anymore until he apologizes. So that does, it does sound, I would think the dwarves here are distinct. I would probably consider them reasonably united behind their faction, but I would actually also consider them to be a completely separate nation from the humans and elves and everyone else around them.
Okay. Interesting. Very cool. Anna, give us some takes here on Sunndi as we, and go outward into your what you got going on here.
Well, Sunndi, I think we have some ancient history that is kind of cool in this area too. We can mention a couple of locations that I think are worth mentioning. We have the Belching Vortex of Luke. Is in the Hestmark Highlands, and that is really. This is part of ancient history. We have Leuku and a lot of these old places that were talked about prior to Great Kingdom, the early stages of Erdi. And we have there's some awesome articles mentioned. Hang on a second, I need to see if I can link to them. Please talk for a minute here while I'm finding it.
All right, so
GH Musings, so he has some. Awesome,
okay.
David Leonard. I put the link to. He has a series on how the Great Kingdom was formed, and he has there's some awesome stuff on this area from that
misclick.
That time period, so to speak, long before the at early on after the migration and stuff. He has some really cool. Long series of articles on how the Great Kingdom came to be, and Leuku and a bunch of other names that you recognize
Luke
from
out,
spells and yeah exactly and you recognize them from spells and magic items and stuff.
Okay,
and there you have some awesome the stories behind this.
Okay.
They played out in this area north of Sunndi and north and south in the Hestmark Highlands. And because we have the one of the key areas for the formation of this is the Theli River, the around there from up from Rel Dev and down to Pontilver is one of these areas that are key to the early formation of
right.
the Great Kingdom.
All this, right
and yeah, so that part, if you read the story, there were several proto, like small kingdoms and warlords or whatever you might call them back in the day that actually were here, so to speak, early on. When these cities, you have Reldeven, Karlstrand, Nulbish, and so on, were established here, Torik, and these cities that were part of getting the Iridian Empire established in this area. And that is so cool. So go back, find these articles and read them and rejoice in ancient stories, the stories behind the stuff that we have in the campaign and from the box set and Living Greyhawk and even the folio and stuff, the earlier times. And I love that. That's Greyhawk archaeology. And this area is central to the development of the setting, so to speak, and how the politics and stuff developed.
Here's my question back to that. No one played here, though, right? Like, who's great?
You have to realize this was the birthplace. This is the Garry's campaign. This is the CNC campaign, the original CNC campaign, the Great Kingdom and stuff. This is where it played out. That's where these stories come from.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm
just saying, though. Are there player characters that we know that were out here? Like,
you talk to players at GarryCon that played in that campaign. You remember that?
I guess so. You're
that
right.
Was here. That was here. That was here. You have the maps that are before the Greyhawk became Greyhawk, when it was the CNC campaign, Castle and Crusade Society, and they had the Great Kingdom, and the map from that area is. That part of the CNC campaign and stuff was placed here in Greyhawk.
Okay.
So this has a history beyond earlier than Greyhawk. And then it was merged in. So there are parts from Garry's personal campaign, CNC Society, and then published Greyhawk. It's all kind of mingled up and convoluted and changed and written over many times, so to speak. And then Carl Sargent came in, and then Living Greyhawk and stuff. And they all tweak little bits here and there and say, oh, it's an inconsistency. It didn't work. So we changed stuff.
Right, right.
But there is a lot of cool ancient history. And David Leonard, he tapped into all of that and wrote a series of articles explaining how this area came to be, so to speak. And it's awesome. And then Samwise continued the story when he tied into the Iron League and all of that. It's so much fun. You can read it, and then you can take all of that and take the bits you want to take all of it, and then you can tweak it slightly to suit your campaign. But you get such a target-rich environment. You have ancient names, you have old heroes, villains, family names, heirlooms, monsters, all sorts of cool stuff. There's stories of atrocities and backstabbing and family feuds. And meaning, you have Game of Thrones stuff here. You have tons of it.
Expanding from what Anna just said, if you go an inch more north, from those places you mentioned, you're in the Bladelands and the Degia and Thaland.
Exactly. And there you have,
Medigia. That's just an inch more north.
Exactly. And Mentre and Medigia and stuff, that's like the papal states of the Great Kingdom. Meaning that was the part of religious center. There were feuds between politics and religion and who should rule. There are Hextorians, there are Heronians, there are tons of cool stuff here that are central to the setting. And yeah, it's super, super cool. And then you have during the war, you had Osson coming and saving Sunndi from Almor and raiding and stuff. So there's so much rich history here that it's thick. It's really, really thick.
It's rich. It's rich, but it kind of gets lost in the shuffle of all the changeovers. And that's the sad thing.
I would say that it just gets written again, so to speak, and again and again. The only rival I see is City of Greyhawk itself. It's the only area that can rival this. But in many ways, this is even richer in not in designated products, but in the amount of stuff that has been written over the years. And because it has had an early story even going into Greyhawk being published. So because the CNC campaign and stuff had tons of stuff here. So there are lots of cool stuff to fall back to.
As I mentioned before, we began just as an offhand comment, I think part of the thing is you have to do the kind of dive, you know, that make a timeline like that to see all the stuff that happened here.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, yeah, absolutely.
Because otherwise, you know, you're going to read one entry. You know, you'll just say, should I set a campaign in Sunndi? And you'll read Sunndi, or you'll get maybe five of the dates from that entire timeline. And you'll go, there's not much happening in Sunndi.
Yeah.
You'll do the same for Idy. You'll do the same for Iron Gate. You'll do the same for Onwall. And they're like, there's not much happening here.
Yeah. So you have when
when you put them all together, though, all of a sudden you go, wait a minute.
Wait a minute. Yeah. So, you have a kingdom like Thaland is a kingdom, for instance, and Medigia, and they were the first wars between Thaland and Medigia is right. And now we're talking a period back in what is it, like probably -200 or something, like -350, something like that. And even then you have Queen Elissa and the Kingdom of Elissa. So you had Flan history here too. And then Oridian's coming in, and this is, you're missing out, Jay. This is an awesome area. Yeah. Come on. Yeah.
And this thing, I have other timelines with other areas that go over all this stuff. Mm-hmm. And it's, I know this goes back to when I did the Sheldamar timeline.
Yep.
When I got involved in LG and I'm doing Keelan, and it wasn't until I actually sat down.
Yep.
And started gathering every reference from every single country affected.
Yeah.
Not just Keelan, all the countries around it, that I started realizing the scope of what's there to work with.
Yep. And hats off to David Leonard. He done an amazing job putting all this together. And it's like 10 chapters. It's absolutely awesome. And you have the Tourney the Merciless. You know, remember him from the story, from the spells, whatever. This was his backyard. He was active here. And then you have Zeldrad that took over from the Sewell house that took over after the Lissa and the Flan kingdom. So you have the Sewell, the Origian, the Flan, the Elves, the Dwarves. Come on, this is a target-rich environment. It's an absolute blast to go in here.
Speaking of,
then we have Ivid the Undying as the top kind of cool on top of it. That adds to a myriad of going back. So if you want to play with history, you want to have cool names of your magic swords belonging to someone somewhere, and stuff like that, old tombs and old liches coming back or whatever, there is so much stuff here that you can feed hundreds of campaigns of this. Yeah.
Oh, for names, Bigby's supposed to have a place in Onwall.
Really?
Morden Kanan, even though he's from the Wild Coast, he's supposed to
have Bigby has a whole place. Yeah.
Yeah, so Bigby has
Bigby's from Aldridge. He's from Aldridge in Realdevin. So
okay,
that's according to the sources from his Wiki page and stuff.
This is really done up because of Living Greyhawk, I'm assuming.
Yes, they added a big layer on of stuff, because Onval didn't have that much old stuff, but it got really built up and added to in Living Greyhawk.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, a bunch of articles there.
Idos from Almore, that's a fan for BBs, it says.
So you have, and the first seven chapters of David Leonard's articles is before Grey Kingdom was even formed.
Oh, that's cool.
It's so good. And then you have the rise of House Garistat and Torcan, for instance, and all the stuff that goes into there. And then come Crandon, Rax, Darman, and Nalax. They all from here. They're not from up there. They're from here, from this area. They were the lords and the families that feuded in the area down here first.
So are they
then
Flan?
They expanded. No, they are Origians. The Origians are settled here first.
Okay.
That's when they fought. This is the base is that valley along the Theli Valley. That's the base of the Origian Empire. Exactly. That's where they fought out. The Thaland and Medigia and so on. And these cities and areas. Huh. There were a lot of little small kingdoms and stuff.
Okay.
that then became provinces and stuff later in the empire. But before then, they had small little kingdoms, and these noble families were smaller families that feuded out and fought wars and stuff over who should rule. And then you had the Zeldrads and in Seoul and stuff, and they were all fighting it out for hundreds of years before the Great Kingdom they could unite and an empire was formed. But you have so much cool stuff to go there. Liu Qiu, the Tyranny, the Merciless, and a whole bunch of stuff where a bunch of people are from that age. But enough of ancient history.
That's
I just
okay.
To
no,
point
I
out
love
that
hearing about
it's
it.
It's so cool that it's there and you can get it, you can grab it, read it, and get inspired. So, yeah.
Because that's what this discussion is all about. Ideas, future, past, and present day, depending on when your present day is.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, all right.
You have some mountains in there too. Glorioles give some height to the landscape. Otherwise, it's fairly flat and small.
I
want to
know
stuff.
who named that.
Glorioles. I think the Glorioles is back from early CNC days, is my guess. And now we're talking Castle and Crusade Society. It's my guess. A lot of the names in this area comes from that pre-Greyhawk period, so to speak, when it was the Castle and Crusade Society. Some of it is probably from Gary's personal campaign, and I'm not really sure what the difference were in some sense, so they might be coming from. But there are sources that are older than published Greyhawk, so to speak. They came in and were played in long before Greyhawk.
I got it. But you understand what I'm saying, but the name.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's really on the border, so.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know English enough. So.
Oh, you don't know English enough.
That's the good thing.
We made all those jokes when the Giants book came out. I pointed out.
Yeah, exactly.
It's from the old mining term.
Okay,
the mining term.
Uh-huh.
Oh, okay.
It's a mother lode strike.
Right, okay, got it.
Now, that's what a glory hole is in mining. It's like when you hit the mother load,
it got corrupted into something else.
Yes.
So there you go.
Yep.
But for anyone wondering,
Now it's been on the map so long that
you
can remove it. So yeah.
So the gray elves. I want to talk about this.
Yeah.
It's mostly gray elves in Sunndi, correct?
I believe.
Hang on a second. Let's go to Living Greyhawk and see what we got here. Living Greyhawk as population. They only said elf gray 9%. So yeah, they don't mention the other.
Right.
So it seems like mostly gray.
Counts a gray elf. Thanks, Amy. So I have it in my game that there is a relation that the gray elves here are related to Selene and Grey Elves, because Selene and Grey Elves are the nobility of Selene, right? So I have it that there are cousins, you know, and
well,
it may
if you
only
live
be one
for
or two,
a thousand years
right.
or more, then you can have relatives living quite
it may
far
only be
away,
one or so. Two generations, because there are not, there's only three places I can find it. There are a lot of Grey Elves. These two in the Lands of the Timeless Tree and Vesvi, and that's it.
Yes.
We've always had that, like my friend Walt's character, Brynamart, actually has relatives that are in Sunndi, and that they sometimes they'll go and adventure there. I mean, rarely, once in a blue moon. And Tim used to run games out here as well, a lot in ID, because a lot of his main characters actually hail from ID. So, once in a blue moon, we would run stuff here. But, yeah, I was just going to say that, there's no migrations of elves or of any of the other the Demi-Hum races. There's, we don't have a chart for them. They were just here, I guess, when humans started coming in right from the other from the kingdoms. Iridians and Flan were always here, supposedly. But I'm just but it makes it an interesting concept that how long the Grail's been here, right?
I did my own extended take on that, which I'll address later.
Okay,
but I mean, given how long a Grey Elf lives. I'm sure they're related, within 3 to 5 degrees.
Okay, yeah.
We're without much effort.
Yeah.
Especially the older ones. So
my question is, did one expatriate to the other? Was Sunndi first or was Selene first?
Well, I have it that Sunndi was first.
Okay.
And then the city of Summer Star split off from it.
Mm-hmm.
And then and at that time, the whole other group of elves decided to go east. And they first formed Selene, and then they formed Luna as an offshoot of Selene. And Luna is what is now the remnants are in the city of the Timeless Tree, and their lesser elves are in High Folk.
Okay. What's your basis for going west, going from Sunndi west? I'm just curious because I tend to agree on that too. I think
the reason is because to go east, they'd have had to plow their way through the Silouese and Backlunish empires, or massively come up through the Sheldamar, and I didn't want to do that.
Okay. Okay.
So I picked they landed in the east and migrated to the west.
Okay. Got it. All right. Reasonable enough than any other discussion. They went this way.
Yeah.
Okay. Interesting. That's just my thought on, because we never have any discussion on, well, where do elves start, right? And you got to throw a lens. You got to throw a lens. Lender Isles out of the equation here. So,
I actually wrote a short little thing on that to reconcile it. So you can say we're using from the ashes, but, and it's simple. Yes, the elves tried to take over Lendor Isle, and then Liamin came back from a mission to another plane in service of Lendor and said, "What are you doing here?" And when the elves got uppity, well, he Liamined it all over them. And eventually they surrendered and agreed to leave Lendor Isle alone. Good. And protect it. So so it happened, but then Liamin came and kicked them out.
Yeah, we didn't need that to become the Grey Havens or whatever the heck.
Yep, no. Yep, they tried taking it over, but Liamin kicked them out. Done.
Anna, so there are all demi-human races here. Halflings, yeah. Gnomes, mm-hmm. Dwarves, and elves.
Yeah, I think there are probably some halflings.
Not a lot of half orcs.
2%.
Not a lot of orcs and half
orcs. No, exactly. The humanoids are kind of almost missing here. So, yeah, they're up in the Bone March and stuff. But I think it's also because both the elves and others don't like them, and the Grey Kingdom, for the most part, probably didn't need them. And so they kind of drove them to their fringes. So they ended up in the Bone March in other areas.
Yeah, there are gnomes here. There are gnomes in these hills.
I think there are some gnomes here and there. And, 3% according to Living Greyhawk, yes, it here. So, yeah.
And what, Sunndi?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Sunndi.
If there are significant halflings, I have it in one of my files that I can double the file. Fine.
They're an ID.
But, there's lots of elves in Sunndi and lots of dwarves and gnomes everywhere else.
XT Candy says there's a gnome port here. That's interesting. Interesting.
So that's
okay. Yeah. So you got your full gamut of the big city to the east. Not Dalstrand, right? Dalstrand is definitely not gnome.
No, I think it's human, but there are some other stuff.
Oh, Gnomeport. It's right here.
Exactly. I was going to say there's a Gnomeport. If it actually has gnomes or not, I'm not really.
Well, assume who the heck. It's not elves or mm-hmm. They're not going to call it Gnomeport, right? So that's pretty funny. Good. Yeah. Wow.
Yep. mm-hmm. Yep. There's a Gnomeport.
Very cool. That's neat. That is neat. So, tell geography wise, these hills seem like, is this like all Scottish Highland like equivalent? Or is it like Appalachians, Rockies? Like, what type of, I always get the feeling these are, when it says hollow highlands, it's like, that's what it is. It's like, the Appalachians, because the Appalachians and the Scottish Highlands are the same mountain range, right? Just plate tectonics.
Yeah, but those it's probably not like those because okay. Hollow mountains get me. I get the sense that it's more like sedimentary rock, more like limestone and stuff. Not, yeah, not so much like the, because the Appalachian is more like the Scandinavian mountains, the Scottish mountains, and because they are the same range.
Yeah, it's the same exact range.
Exactly. And they are old, old, worn down. So it's basically very eroded bedrock. They're made out of granite and really, really hard core mountains, so to speak. But so it, they are much more like, I would say, the Pyrenees, the Apennines in so more limestone, sedimentary rock that has been raised up because that is something that can be eroded away by water and stuff. That's where you find a lot of caves. There are very few caves in old rock that is really, really hard, like in the Scotland or the Scandinavian mountains, and I bet in the Appalachians probably not that many. But if you take on the Balkans, for instance, there you have perfect examples of limestone and stuff. There are tons of rocks. Thailand is another area that have these kind of limestone sedimentary rocks that have lots and lots of parts of China, Southeast Asia has a lot of these kind of old cement sedimentary rock. Eastern Europe, Southeastern Europe has lots of them too. But you have some super big caves and stuff.
Okay.
I was gonna say, as I recall,
but it's sorry, what?
sorry, I was gonna say, Dennis has the
Alden
lands and Iron Hills around Iron Gate as being karst.
Yeah. And karst is one of these where the surrounding landscape have eroded away and you have a hard core rock that still sits there, so to speak.
Yeah, and I think he used some pictures of like the coast off the
Yeah.
Dalmatian coast.
Yep.
The
And
Illyrian coast. I'm
yep.
sorry, I still think in Roman terms.
Yep. But
I got
so
you
you
right.
have
Yeah.
and it's yeah.
I guess it's Croatia down to
Yep.
down to Albania now. So that kind of coastal area for
Yeah, they have lots of caves. I've been to several of them in the those areas, and they're gorgeous. And that's like soft rock that water can erode over times.
All right, so these are old mountain ranges, is what you're saying. They're still very
Yeah, they're
old.
probably yeah, and they
Okay.
might have been like old seafloor. But now we talk. Now I'm making real world comparisons. You don't have to. This is a fantasy world. You can invent your
Right.
own fantasy geological processes that produces caves or something. So that's the thing. We're talking fantasy geology here. So we can imply some D&D physics that can kind of bridge us over to cool stuff as needed, so to speak.
Okay.
Yeah. But it's always good to know how it works in the real world and then make fantasy versions of it.
Right.
At least that's how I want to do it, so to speak. I want to understand how these things could be made because we want to have like basic idea of following the real world. Other meaning you can have a river that flows uphill, but not every river needs to, meaning gravity should work generally as it does in the real world. And then you can have exceptions or something for some cool reason.
And just to pop back a moment, one key group of halflings in the region are the hobloggers of Iron Gate.
Right.
Yep.
And let me see if I can bring that up real quick.
Course, well, the thing about the hobloggers is their backstory, their origin. Way back, we were just discussing Iron Gate, and this, when I say way back, I'm talking still
We go.
Thursday night group days. We were discussing Iron Gate and the question of, is Iron Gate on the north coast or the south coast? It had not been settled at the time.
Oh, really?
Right. This is, like I say, this is still like
Wow.
before Greyhawk 98, before LGG. So
Okay.
it hadn't been resolved yet. And I said, well, given the map scale and the whole Darlene city twitchy thing, I sort of assumed that it was on both.
Here, there's
You know,
pictures of
that
the
the
geology right
strait was
here.
narrow enough. And they said, well, wait, it can't be that. How do they get through? There's a canal there. And he said, well, a canal, how would they dig a canal through that? And yeah, you can see all Dennis's pictures of the
Yeah.
karst. And I just said, well, the Hobnis dug it.
Oh,
And Fred quipped, hobloggers.
there. That's how you got it. That's
And
cool.
it just became a running joke that I ran with that that Dennis eventually embraced just for the sheer humor that, yes, there is a guild of halflings that get those trees on those isolated karst peaks and bring them to support the port north and south of Iron Gate.
And here's Tam Coslin. Looks like he's the guild master, huh? Oh, he's notable active members of the guild. Crew chief. There you
and
go.
And there's another fun article there. Scratzivort, the deity of the Hobloggers. Which is, well, let's just say I got a little too absurd for my own good with that one. Or maybe too absurd for sane people's good for that one. But it's something fun to look at.
You can always have a good time with your Greyhawk here. I don't know if I can find it. Oh, here it is. Deity of squirrels. Huh?
Yes. Yes. And gliding mammals.
Hey, Folkemyth. That is funny. The gliding mammals.
I explain why. You know, if Raxivort can be the deity of rats and bats, which are completely unrelated.
Right.
Scratzivort can be the deity of squirrels and gliding mammals.
First nut.
Yes.
Yeah, I think you were tooting something out of the hookah here on this one.
Oh yeah. I couldn't help it. I just started writing it, and it just got more and more ridiculous.
Tweaky the Hooded. All right, that's enough, Bruce. Oh my god. Bullwinkle the Mook.
Yes.
Yes. All right. So I don't feel too bad. We putting in Ace Tomato Company into my into my Altamira box set. So there you go. Wow. So that's cool. That you're saying now that Maldon is the one that made the determination about the geology. Is that what you're saying?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
And I think he may have been the one who decided that it was on the south coast that, you know, that got accepted by everybody.
Because there is now a city on the north. I don't know when that appeared.
LGG.
Okay. So, Annie, what are your thoughts?
Well, I like the idea of having a tunnel or like a canal there. Makes perfect sense to build it. And when you have magic, you can kind of you can dig through mountains fairly
spells,
quickly,
yeah.
So to speak. And also having a water canal underwater makes it a lot more sense because it's very much easier to transport the rock out, so to speak, when you can use ships to do it. That makes a lot of more sense than if you have to use horse-drawn carts and something like that. So you can move equipment and haul it out. So that makes more sense.
Okay.
And it also it huge economic reason for it, because, and especially since you have the Scarlet Brotherhood having scanned and blue, that means that it's a lot less risky. You can haul goods between North Anchor and Iron Gate and do it in a much safer way than you can going around Onval when you have Scarlet Brotherhood and stuff there. So it makes a lot of sense to have a canal there.
Nice catch, the new Tim. Yes. Yes. Ace Tomato Company. You got it. You nailed it.
Cool. Yeah.
So, is speaking of Onval, is Scant the place where A0 takes place? Where's A0 take place?
Dark Shelf you have to go up north.
Oh,
go
it's up here. It's up here. Okay.
There, exactly. Yep. Mm-hmm. There you go.
What lands?
One of the few models I knew that is part of Nyrond.
Border. Huh? Okay.
Yeah, I moved Nyrond border up there just because of Dark Shelf, because it seems to fit the story, or at least I assume so. Yeah.
We all do silly stuff. We all write silly stuff. We get in one of those moods where we're like, we're going to run with this. I mean, we all have done it, you know? So.
Yeah.
Well, Tim, I'm going to call you New Tim because we got like seven Tims on here. Enoch Pratt and Sir Timothy, like I said, from Stronghold and the Ever Mysterious Tim. And so we are We are right there in that old school realm, so you're in good company. All right, so that's Dark Shelf. Danger Dark Shelf Quarry. Yep, okay, duh, I should remember that. Am I remembering this because Scant supposedly was magically taken over by the Scarlet Brotherhood? Is that what I'm remembering?
I vaguely recall it was like one of the last places the Scarlet Brotherhood was holding or something.
Was holding, okay. Okay.
And then it got blown up or something during LG.
Well, everything got blown up in LG.
Yeah. I unfortunately, that I don't recall too much. I was too busy crashing on Keeland.
Don't worry. It's a term of endearment, new Tim. Trust me. You'll see when you see all the Tims come out. It's like it's Tim Heaven here. So they were conquered by the Scarlet Brotherhood. All right. I got another. We're in a navy of these. That's probably a lot of the problem. There are no good navies here, right? I mean, every time.
Yeah,
Anna.
Yeah, yeah. I was going to say we have the Scarlet Brotherhood. Scarlet Brotherhood having a navy in the area, and my guess is that Savener in Karlstrand, he wouldn't let that go. Meaning he has port cities in lots of places. I think he will give Scarlet Brotherhood a run for its money fairly quickly. Once he get a grasp of power, he wants to expand. And his Dorman backers and stuff, they want silches, they want trade stuff. So my guess is that he will start getting, because he has ports, he has Neri, and in the Neri, he has several ports. And on the south, he has ports along the Alyssan coast, like Trenton Port and Prim, for instance. And then he also has Pontilver that he can rebuild. It was kind of ruined during the war and all that, but he can rebuild it again. And so he will have openings on numerous coasts and has the economy and the scale, so to speak, and resources to build ships and stuff. So I would say that I would have a United Kingdom of Alyssa as an up-and-coming, after the war, up-and-coming naval power.
Yeah.
And Nyrond up in the north, already an established one, but they have much further down. But if they, Iron League, if they can send their ships through the down to Iron League without going around Onval, and even if they can go around Onval, if they have friendly ports down there in Iron Gate, for instance, they can help back up Iron Gate's strength.
I think there's more than two Michaels, Mike, Zudrak. There's Mike Saxton, Mike, yeah, I think there's more than two. So, yeah, Von Moku's Michael, it's 3-3.
Yeah. By the LGG, the Duxchan, Lordship of the Isles, is essentially now at war with anyone not part of the Scarlet Brotherhood in the Azure Sea. So they're going to be fighting, you know, the new base at Neri. They'll be fighting Iron Gate. They'll be fighting Keeland. And, well, Principality of Ulek. Probably allied with whatever slavers are in the Pomarge, and of course allied with whatever the Scarlet Brotherhood holds on in the Sea Princes, and fighting whatever Nyrond is sending out through the Sea of Gear.
You're making me bleed out my ears, man.
Well,
stay on the right side. I'll live. I'll live with them there. So, I'm not going to go into Scarlet Brotherhood. This is not a Scarlet Brotherhood discussion today, right? So, could someone?
I agree.
yeah, please. Could someone explain this to me? Explain me this question. Why is this getting changed from ID to Neri? Why is that? Does anyone know?
Yeah, I don't know. It happened in Living Greyhawk with the Living Greyhawk Gazetteer. That before then, it was ID.
Because it's a city. They named it for the city to strip away the old county and create a new province based on the city.
I guess it was Over King Savener who wanted to change the name, but as a way of showing that he conquered it.
Yeah, maybe because there's a city named Neri and they just named it after the city.
Yeah. But why someone came up with this? I look at it from an inn setting perspective. Savener, when you conquer something, it might be a good idea to rename it in that way.
I will show it.
Yeah, you know, to make it clear that no, it's not in the Iron League anymore. It's a new territory.
Okay. Because I don't think we ever asked that question when we had the one for Living Greyhawk. I don't recall. I mean, because there's a lot going on in ID here, too. They really filled this out. Yeah. Over those 8 years, it wasn't that 8 years because they got them late, if I recall. They got they got this territory. I don't know. I don't remember 100%, but they've done a lot to it and added a lot of, like, I'm interested, like, in weird stuff like this. Like, let's go. What is this all about, right?
These yeah, that's from, is that from 83 or from those Dragon articles? Yeah, ID built a series of fortresses to protect that pass. Apparently, it's only like around 30 miles wide that or less between the Iron Hills and the Hollow Highlands. That's access for from Alyssa.
So you're saying Bob Mocha says that Scarlet Brotherhood named it Neri. Interesting. Jeez. All right. Oh, so okay. So you got a defensive area here from the South Province from at the time.
Yeah.
Kind of like this valley. I think it's cool. And I'm shocked there's not more in here, but I guess because there's so much warring going on, you can't really have play at the time. You couldn't place anything.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, you can march an army through that. Tell me about it. Absolutely. But, I mean, the dwarves could really almost do what they did to the Teutoburg Forest. Yeah. Both, like they did the well, Germans and the Romans here. Yeah.
From Dragon 63, basically they did.
Okay, in Dragon 63? Let me bring that up.
I think it's in 63 where they explain it. Yeah, or is it 57 under the South Province version? But yeah, they
North Province, Sea of Medesia, Solnor Ocean is probably in the other one. All right, let me go back to 57.
Well, remember, because you get Sunndi and Idy in here.
Here's the South Province. All right. Interesting. Jellor instead opted to winter as Elder 10 is forced to be. So
there it is.
Page what? Am I on the right page? 15?
Yeah, no, page 15, above just above the paragraph above the troop count.
Right here. Men of Sunndi harassed the flank of General Raynard's force from the safety of Rewood. But this was a mere annoyance. Late in the summer, the general led his force across the arm of the Hollow Highlands. The plan was to march the combined force into Southern ID. How's our troops in it? All right, a cautious advance. It only says a cautious advance at best. It doesn't say that anything beyond.
Well, says, the thing is they did stop them. And I think it comes out in Greyhawk Wars that it wound up rather bad for Chellor. Especially when Austin showed up.
Interesting. All right. Well, that's cool. Knowing, I mean, these dragons go back. I mean, we're talking about a Dragon 57. So you're talking about, what's the date on this? Is it 1980?
Yeah. Yeah, like right after the Folio came out.
Yeah, I mean, it's really early when you think about. Thanks, Cyber. I mean, trying to find a date in this is almost impossible. January 82. Okay. It's a little bit before that.
Okay, yeah.
But still, the box set's not out yet. So you do not have, like I said, you have no named, like, only in these articles do you have named of leaders. You still don't have the names of leaders because in the 80 box set, they didn't give them to you.
They kept the names of the leaders in the box set, but surprisingly, he didn't update it with these events in the box set.
Right. Because 80, it just shows you their level. It has no names next to them, just titles. Titles and class. So, all right, so some highlights you both want to talk about in this area while we continue this discussion. What do we got? Anna?
Let's see here. We got...
Tell me about Menowood. Is this wooded highlands? Is that what that is?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right, tell us.
It's one of these... that a little bit hard to always say, but it's hard to, because there should be greenery all over the place, and I kind of made some hill, some trees in other places, but for some reason or the other, there is more trees there than there could be, that they were chopped down in other areas, or there might be, yeah, whatever reason. So it's a little bit hard sometimes that some hills are much more wooded than the neighboring hills. It's usually because of some sort of, either it's some geology catastrophe, volcanoes or whatever, something, or it might be some creature that goes around and chopping down the trees. So, but I think it's cool. And you see that I made it a bit different texture, showing this is kind of subtropical, like jungle. So this is like bushy jungle, so it's one of the warmest forests in the Flannies. You have them down in the southwest. You have the same.
So we're not talking about large evergreen ip trees and all that stuff. We're talking about smaller.
Well, up in the hills, the trees tend to be smaller because you don't have that much deep soil to put down your. And also, hills are usually windier. So trees that were far up in the hills, they tend to be smaller than the ones. But on the other hand, it depends on the local condition. Tree varies a lot from one. If you go a few hundred yards away or a mile away, then it depends, so to speak. So, but when you go if you go higher up and stuff, they tend to be smaller. But that's something you can take from area to area. But and also a lot of jungle trees are really, really tall. But you have, what characterizes jungle often is that it's, first of all, it's green all year round. It's been around for a long time. It's very stable. And it might be that there is rainier in that area than the other ones. So for some reason, that is like take islands, for instance. They often have some areas that are much more rainy than others. And so it might be due to local wind conditions and stuff like that. So that why you end up with a lot of trees in one little spot. Or that someone hasn't chopped them down.
What are the inhabitants of this in the book?
I was about to get to that. Two things. Thank one, Fun mentions werewolves of the Mena Wood. Okay. One of the adventure cards in the gold box set.
Yeah.
Not a card. It would just be one of the adventure hooks in the book. But the encounter table for the Mena Wood, where it says use standard encounter table, it has a note, use standard fairy encounter tables.
Okay so it's cool. Very fairy. Yeah.
It might be lower hills. That might be where the forest is there.
There are Trents and unicorns there and fairy critters.
Yeah, we're talking 83 box. You're talking 83 box set for the werewolves in the Meadowwood, right? You're not talking about the Free City Greyhawk box set.
Well, he says gold box, so I'm guessing it was.
Are you talking 83?
Yeah, that would be the 83. And like I say, there are fairies there.
Okay, so brownies and stuff.
I might suspect there's some. Well, they're on the encounter table. There's some also notable elven presence. Yeah, their sylvan elves are supposed to be there.
Okay, so what else? All right. No towns at all, which is interesting.
Well, yeah. like most of the things, very few towns are shown.
Yeah. All right. Because I'm trying to think of myself of another place that maybe the northern part of the Vesvi that is wooded hills that elves, there's not very few, wooded hills that elves occupy, right? Normally it's in flat plains areas, like up here maybe, right? Up here, right? You get this running all along the entire ridge, right? But you know, Selene, there's no, look, it's, there's no forested hills really. So it's not silver, none of them. Silverwood, Axewood, Dreadwood. But here you get it, which is an interesting little change. Mm-hmm. So
yep.
It's interesting. Hornwood, is Hornwood wooded hills?
Maybe.
Hornwood is over in Joff, I think.
No? Yes.
Yeah.
Hornwood's Jeff.
Oh, yeah. That's very, very hilly. Up.
Yeah, you're right too, Amy. You're right. Yeah.
Part of the Cron Hills gnarly is wooded hills.
True, true.
Yeah.
Mostly gnomes, though, right?
Gnomes and elves. Yep. Someone asked about giants and the glorials. They're not on the, you know, the special you know, the limited encounter table. You know, they could be when you use the standard encounter table. But Hestmark Highlands and Glorials does have orc soldiery and also general humanoids.
Okay.
So Degia has been sending them in to cause trouble.
Because this is snow-capped, I'm assuming this is the largest of the mountain ranges, the highest of all of them around here, Anna?
Yeah, the Glorials. Oh, yeah, definitely. They should not have that much snow on them.
Oh, okay.
That was something. They should have less snow, but there will probably be a little bit of in the winter. I'm sure there's snow up on top, but in the summer there might be a little bit of a dusting on the top, but not much because we are so far south that they need to be significantly high. But I have them at maybe they're like 10,000 feet or something. The highest peaks there.
There's an obscure reference. You know what you can see from. Them, I think you can see
described as mountains, not
one
hills.
Of the cities there. Yeah. You can see one of the cities, and of course, I'm forgetting it. And this was something else we did calculate, try to do calculations as to how high it would have to be.
Yeah.
And so apparently it's pretty big.
Yeah, they're described as real mountains, and that's where I have them at. That they're probably at least 3,000 feet. There might be 8,000 feet. Yeah, or maybe even 10,000 feet tall or something in that range.
I would say that's probably.
Yeah, 10,
well,
15.
Maybe you can see gray flood from it.
Yeah.
So
it's probably Calstrand.
Yeah, I like I say, I forget, but I remember we had a discussion.
Well, we have Krunbursch is one dwarven place there, and then we have. And there's two peaks, Bolhörgin up in the north, and then you have Kilvangath near Krunbursch in the center range. And then we have the Anbeck Valley, that's the Anbeck Pass, that going through in the middle. So there is like, that you can actually get from western part over to the eastern part, and or like from the south to the north. And then you have it's kind of, but it makes Sunndi more interesting because you have real mountains too, and it's kind of interesting. Karlstrand would be, if it were in the real world, it would be kind of a skiing subtropic or a really nice warm place with skiing next door. So yeah, so it's a little bit like California or something. You have a lot of different biomes or like climates and stuff nearby. So you have temperate, you have almost Arctic, or at least subarctic up in the high mountains, and subtropical, continental, humid, and stuff. So it's a lot of different climates to play with. You have forest and open lands. You have the Elysian Plains. You have lots of stuff. Lots of rivers in that area too. You have the important river is the Theli. We talked a little bit. You have the Grey Flood. That floats through the Elysian, that has the city of Hexpools, one of the most forgotten cities in the Flan in Greyhawk, I think. It's, you have it there. Zoom in. Go a little bit south and a little bit south. There you go. There you have Hexpools, one of the most forgotten cities in Greyhawk.
Large.
Yeah, it's a large city, and it's kind of almost forgotten in the. It was there, it was named and placed, and then no one really picked it up. It got overlooked, so to speak, by a lot of places. And yeah, Seldraton has a lot more history to it, but Hexpools was one of these, someone invented it, put it there, and then no one picked it up and made cool stories and stuff about it. So it's kind of one of the, it's ripe for development, so yeah. Mm. Mm-hmm. And it's an interesting area that has, and you have the strategic pass, the Azunt Valley that goes between Neri and Elisa.
Yeah, we were talking about that with the keeps.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, with the keeps over there. So the town of Eekhold is there. So, and a lot of those names down in Neri comes from the Living Greyhawk era because of them. And one old is Minetha. I love the name. It's really cool. That's from ancient stories, and it's there too. And then we have any other kind of
Well, here, I have two I was wanted to ask about. Near Kalstrand is Wraith Watch.
It looks
ruined. Don't know anything about that.
Yeah, let's see. I can Wraith Watch. Let's put it in here.
There's Enoch Prack. That's another Tim there, a new Tim. And then this.
It's from OJ17.
Oh!
Earth Journal 17. That's where it's mentioned.
Huh.
And, yeah, it seems like it because that's the hit I got. So I need to refine my search before I'm completely.
Then the Belching Vortex of Luke O.
Yep. It's from page 17 in... it's a ruined border keep, crowns a rocky hill some 4 leagues south of Kalstrand at the very feet of the Glorioles. Built toward the southern approaches to the city, was assaulted by a force of Sunndian soldiers bolstered by a company of glorious dwarfs in the last weeks of the Greyhawk Wars. That's how it got ruined. Yep, that's where I got that story from. So, OJ17.
Okay, cool.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
No, Jeff, you're definitely not a Tim. All right, and then this Belching Vortex of Luco.
Yeah. Oh. That's from the Dungeon Master's Guide first edition.
Okay. That's where it's placed. All right, cool.
Yeah, I placed it there because of the old stories from the same stories that David Leonard based his analysis of, so to speak. So I used the same sources to place
it
there.
Nice, Mike.
So, yep.
Very cool. All right, so I got one map, a picture to show. So I do have one map here, and that is not a map, but and if you ever read up on Dungeon Meister, he's got his Living Greyhawk story. It's based around the character Laurel Lee, mage thief, Grey Elf. Her best friend gets killed in the wars when they fight in Ayuz. This is all Living Greyhawk. And then she wanders, so she ends up in the ancestral lands of her grandmother in Sunndi. And here's a picture of the plains of Sunndi with all the elves. Because elves like to go shirtless here, so there you go. Yeah, and this is the grandmother here. Yeah, so there. Pretty neat. Pretty neatly done. Looks like the elves like straw huts. I don't know. They can't be huts. That's just cutting the fields and the way they... Yeah, so. Neat picture. So, yeah, isn't that really cool? Elves. All gray elves. And they all have blonde hair, so, yeah. Thanks, Engarman. Thank you very much. Almost in our hype train. So there you go. One of my few contributions to tonight. You can be a Grugok, but Grugok district, so they don't bathe either, so they smell there, Jeff. So what do we want to say here closing out this in a discussion? This has been great. Got way more information than I ever thought of, and I'm so happy, Sam, you said you'd come on tonight because, that timeline and all that that's awesome.
Yeah.
So if you want that time, if the audience wants it, where could they get it? Wait a minute. Would you be willing to give that out on
that? Ask me? That's like a 0.1. that I might at some future, I don't think I'm ever going to get over there to really develop, do an Iron League article. Anyone wants it, I can pop it up in, like the Cannon Fire Discord server and
there you go.
Can come along and grab it.
Yeah, I think that would be good. So, especially if you're playing or planning on playing in this area, it's a good thing to have. It has some really great points on it. It'd help you with the campaign. So just letting you know that it is Sam did the work. So there you go. I know Amy says that would be awesome. So there you go. Really cool. So what do we say in closing on this? Because I guarantee you the shout-outs may take a while tonight.
Go there and adventure. It's a great area with a lot of cool stories and history, and it's definitely not on the wrong side of the map, in my opinion.
Okay. What are your thoughts, Sam? I mean, you did some really great work here, and I really appreciate it.
Yeah,
I'd say it's an area that, like Helant, you're not going to see the potential until you really look at the entire Iron League. And once you do, and once you, you know, like I say, look at these notes, there's so much to develop there.
Yeah, it appears there's a lot.
Just, you know, I can't, like I say, it's not my area. I'm a Sheldamar guy. You know, I snuck into the Central Planets and tore into that. But yeah, so this is, it's not my area, but just looking at that list, I can see so many stories waiting for somebody to, you know, develop them in whatever period they like.
I've always said this, and I say this every time we have a show now, it seems, we need people to play, like, thanks Fuzz, hopping up that hype. Thanks, second hype of the night. We really need someone to even run some historical. I mean, historical, that's not the right term. Run a game before 576 in one of these, or an adventure idea. We're going to do some of them in our campaign upcoming. We're definitely going to do some historical games. We're going to have special characters that may be relatives, or something like that. So, here, I'll give you some Discords here. I'll give you the Discords. There's going to be two.
Yeah, in fact, I just put it up in Greyhawk.
All right, there's the Cannon Fire Discord. Okay. And then our Greyhawk Events Discord, which is really good for cons, fundraisers, for Virtual GrowCon and stuff. So sign up for both. You're more than welcome to join. Thank you for the second hype. We're doing two giveaways for Classic D&D reprints, two ethereal badges, and four gift badges tonight, okay? And they're all virtual badges for Virtual GaryCon, that part of GaryCon. So, yeah, we're doing a whole bunch of giveaways, too. Awesome. Any other questions? Let me just scroll through. If Demi-Human, watch out for random Wastry and cults. Yes, BB, and you know me, I love Wastry. It's my favorite. One of my favorites. Of all time. So Coco believes that signing up late will get her to win because she saw what happened to Assure last time. You know, getting that win late. It's just Dale. Dale's not on everyone, I don't think, tonight. I think he's got a game tonight, so you don't have to worry about Dale winning again for the 12th time. Yes. The blessing of Wastry. What a wonderful, wonderful thing.
Oh. Okay, well, I mean, this is like just a completely random thought.
Go for it.
Wastry. If you have Wastry, if you use the Sergeant powers, you have Raminos. This was just a twisted thought I had, you know, about a year ago. If you have a cult of Raminos, but you make him a little less chaotic evil, because he's supposed to be, you know, constantly intoxicated, you know, slumbering most of the time. So you get someone who's slumbering, intoxicated, laid back. He's the dude.
The dude. He's the dude.
He's the dude. So you get these laid back cultists of Wastry, of Raminos versus the vicious cultists of Wastry, and you know who will win in the battle for the hearts and minds of the amphibians of the vast swamp. And this led to, you know, a joke that's been going on for over a year. Who will be the Toad Warrior? And then I think it was Lee who quit, you know, and you know, or one of the other guys who quit, you know. And the sequel, Furry Road.
The rug, it really put the room together, man.
So, there you go.
What a great movie.
The dude and a laid-back cult of Raminos in the vast swamp instead of just the vicious Wastrians.
You guys know I don't drink White Russians. I drink Kahlua's and cream. No, I can't do it. Putting that in there, oh my God. No vodka in my, yeah. You actually had that rug in your campaign next door. I can see that. I mean, I can see that being a focal point of especially someone from the 90s. The rug. That's funny. All right. So, do some quickie shout outs here. Anna, what's going on?
First, quick. I need to shout out from Tom Kelly, Thomas Kelly. He made, we've collaborated a bit. I sent him some stuff that I've written on various topics, excuse me, and he edited and refined it and made sure that all my linguistic cock-ups were kind of removed. So he made it much more palatable and easy to read. So he started out now with naming Yggdrasil. It's my take on Yggdrasil and a little bit of true names and stuff. So I'm going to copy the link. So thank you so much, Thomas, for helping me out with this. So that is kind of a cool thing. A lot of people say, oh, where it comes from. It's my take on Yggdrasil. I used all the information I can find, published sources, fan-made stuff, whatever. So all the stuff that I could find on Yggdrasil over the years and then do it. There's one bit that was not in here. Might be that I forgot to, I added that after I sent it to Thomas. That was the early bit of when Yggdrasil grew up as Baba Yaga. That's the Baba Yaga connection, so to speak. It's not in this part, so I'll make sure that I send that to Thomas so he can add it or as a second period. I need to elaborate on it because it's a little bit brief. I think there is more to be had there, and it's I would say that it doesn't stay. It may place an homage to the official story of Yggdrasil, both to the early ones, but also to the later editions where you Yggdrasil and Tasha is the same. I assume that is true, so to speak. But I also twisted some of it. The Grast's role, for instance, he's involved just like he is, but his role is a bit different. And his motives are a bit different. And I use this in there, of course, as the love child, so to speak, and Drelsna and a bunch of others. So the antagonists and the people you expect to be there are in the story. Some of their roles are a bit different. So I don't take everything at face value. I kind of tweak some of it in order to fit the story of my campaign. So cherry pick what you like and skip the parts you don't like. But it's a good example of how you can take a story and you can kind of weave it in and create something. So thank you, Thomas, for helping me out with that part. Yeah.
Very, very cool. And you're on, yeah. Are you on Friday night?
Yep. I'm on Friday night and I'm really, I'm not going to show it yet. But I have some really, really cool stuff to show at GaryCon.
Nice.
I've done some renders, and I've done some, and they turned out really, really good. So I'm
awesome.
Yeah, I'm. It's good. It's they're coming to be something that blows socks off. So yeah, it's good. Yeah. So it's coming. Yep. I know there's been not showing anything because I want to hold the cards close for a bit.
I know. I have trouble doing that. I'm gonna show something. I guarantee you. We're going to get at least one laugh.
Okay, yeah.
I got to put some stuff up, then put more up. I'll go next in it for shout-outs, and then I'll have Sam go.
But I'm working on textures and stuff, and now I will definitely have 100,000 square miles rendered fairly properly by GaryCon, which when you see this...
Is that going to be yours, or is that going to be at Ed's? Which one are we going to see that at?
Oh, we'll see. I might tease something, but mine is probably before Ed's. Or hang on a second. I think it is. I need to look at the. Hang on a second here.
Ed's. We already got a dozen signups, and it's only going through gold. It's insane. That's going to sell out the Ed one.
Yeah, events I'm hosting. So let's see here. We have. Yeah, I have mine first. So, but if there's people who haven't seen it, I will definitely show some of it but you said legendary maps. Mine are so new, so they can't be legendary.
Yeah, they can't
because they haven't been showed. But okay, they might be legendary in the future. So.
Yeah, exactly.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So, what happens when your heroes do something very well, but it releases a wave of energy, like in the fundraiser when the sun was banished, throughout the Sus Forest? Answer, you awaken a lot of things. So this is a picture of five nights of Yulek, all high-level characters. It's going to be starting tomorrow night, and just waves and waves of, yes, as you can see, coming out from every orifice around. So, just so you're aware, this is stage, of course, this pick, but I had to do it, and I haven't even gotten the ads out yet.
Yep.
Awakening of the Sus starts tomorrow night. So, good things happen. other bad things happen from that. That's tomorrow night's Gamescape 3D giveaway. Also throw in some Reaper minis for those who don't have a 3D printer. Then Saturday morning, prepare yourself. Prepare yourself for me getting abused, okay? And other people. So the following people, myself, Patrick, an ancient gamer, Alan's playing, and Coco Bunny's playing in this game. And we go, finally, go back to the city-state Invincible Overlord. This got rescheduled from when I got sick during the fundraiser. The Cavalier who came to dinner with Tim DMing. I have my 13th level Cavalier, Dervilia, in this. It's going to be just crazy. Crazy times in this because, you know, Tim is over the top. So we'll see how the ever-mysterious Tim is over the top on this. And there's, yeah, so that will, that's 9 a.m., okay? 9 o'clock, and we'll have some kind of giveaway minimum on that. So, nope, not true, Greg. I'll be there as soon as we go, as soon as I switch out. And then Sunday, this is going to be a great interview, two back-to-backs. Anthony Pryor. Now you go, who the hell's Anthony Pryor? Well, where did I put them? All right, so he did this. So he did Patriots of Ulick. Okay. It's a good effort. He also did this. Rowdy the Traitor. Right? He also wrote the Lankmar 2E book. Pretty good. He also got his start in my love. Yes, Lankmar. Battletech. He did a ton of Battletech ones. We're going to have a great discussion. He's really laid back and chill. I'm looking forward to it. Awesome. Sunday evening.
I think I had that one.
Yeah, More Tales of the Black Widow Company. Yeah. He did Wolf Dragoon's book. He did Twycross. So it'll be a fun discussion with Anthony Pryor. Did a lot of D&D content. And yes. Cool. The Battletech novels. If you're doing the Force Succession War scenario, Rob, they're great. They're great with Justin Jong Allard. They're fantastic. You should read those. Are wonderful books. So that's Sunday. So that'll finish up the week. And remember, everyone, I'm in Vegas next week. After this Sunday night cabin, the next stream will be the next Sunday because I will be in Vegas for work at KBIS, which is a convention, kitchen and bath convention. So what are you doing? What are you up to there, Sam? What do you got going?
Okay, well, first I'm just going to tip a note to something old. Back in Earth Journal 24, there is Zayt Shah, the Alvin Kingdom of Helios. One of my earlier things, a take on the elves of Sunndi.
Excellent.
And I've evolved a little bit since then, but it's still a lot of it is still pretty much what I intend. The big thing I've got is that I just put in. This is my Peoples and Cultures of the Flaneys netbook.
Oh, cool.
Now you'll go, why just a netbook? Because I'm doing it in coordination with the Grey Grimoire, Norker, Ewan Cummins, edited it for me, and a bunch of other people doing it, read parts and gave me some feedback. Because it is 93 pages.
Wow.
Plus 4 pages of the introduction, bibliography, and, just the preliminaries. It covers every reasonably humanoid-looking creature I could find from the encounter tables.
Wow.
That really spans AD&D 1 and 2. And then a bunch of things I brought in from 3-5 sources. And it's part of it everyone may have read. It's the giants that appeared in Visions of Greyhawk. But this is my take on everything. Humans, demi-humans, humanoids, and then lizard men, kobolds, zvarts, Batrachian races, you know, bullywugs, aquatic races, Lokothaw.
Nice.
And even some elemental creatures, all focused on being Flaneys, Greyhawk applicable. I explain in the introduction, there's a whole lot of stuff on a bunch of these, especially, everybody knows the Roger Moore articles from Dragon. and I love them, but they're not Greyhawk specific. You know, there's other stuff like the Giant Craft for Forgotten Realms. You know, this stuff is great for Forgotten Realms, for other settings, and I wanted to do Greyhawk. And also part of that, I wanted to really look at the humans. One of the things that I felt in From the Ashes and later the LGG, they went on this trend to portray the humans as all the human ethnic groups are unmixed after 1,000 years. Uh-huh. That everyone's a pure blood everywhere. And no, I mean, it's quite explicit in the original Dragon articles and then in the 83 set that most people are mixed, you know, in the Flenaes. And I wanted to address that. I wanted to show, yes, okay, humans once looked like this. The different human groups look like this. But now they've mixed, and now they look different.
Cool.
And
awesome.
Just,
yep.
And like I say, it's over 90 pages.
It's cool work, man. Awesome.
Yeah.
And this is one of the big things. I've got more coming out. Eunice currently working through my cosmogony. I wrote an entire multiverse creation myth for Earth. Wow. And the generations of the powers for going, you know, up to about 10,000 years ago. And then, you know, it's a little addressing some of the later powers that were promoted to become powers and hero powers, especially. I promote a whole bunch of other people with names, you know, that relates to another article I had in the Grey Grimoire about the Circle of Eight. And I said, yeah, the retired people, they're promoted. They're hero powers now. They deserve the promotion. They've been around long enough. After he finishes that, I've got my Central Flanaise Gazetteer that I mentioned. And then I have an ancient history timeline.
Oh my
I took,
God, dude.
Yeah, I can't stop.
it's like a drug.
Hopefully all of these will be by the end of the day. My ancient history is I went to the start of the calendars. The Sewell calendar is over 6,000 years old.
Oh, my gosh.
So from year, okay, now I don't have an event for every year. For most of them, it's, you know, every 200 or 300 years. When I got to the Flan, I did a lot for the Flan. I tried to get an event every 100 years or so for them. But I go listing, you know, dynasties for the Flan. I list the various Earthflan tyrants that run around. And I try to give the history, look, a consolidated history up to the Twin Cataclysms.
Awesome, man.
And
good,
then
good reading.
Hopefully for another project that I'm constantly trying to get going with Gary Holian is my Vecna revision.
You better get it out quick because there's a book coming out. And
yes, I need to pester Gary some more to go over it. I have done the history of Vecna. And to a large awesome. Degree, this would be an extension of the parts I wrote for Core Beliefs in Dragon Magazine. You know, thanks to Eric Mona for actually remembering me and asking me to write that. You know, and Sean did the core parts. I have a different take. The Vecna I use is more inspired by Vecna Lives, where he's really focused on being a power of secrets and not of undead. And I expand on my Vecna artifacts roaming around the Flanaes. That's an article you can find on Cannon Fire. And I wrote short histories of a bunch of the wielders of the Hand and Eye of Vecna.
Well, I appreciate that. And,
yep.
You know, it may be better than what comes. Who knows? It may be better than what comes out. We all know that. So
again, it's going to be Greyhawk. It's not going to be multiversal. It's going to be Greyhawk,
which is awesome. Lots are going to be Greyhawk going on. Let's hope. So very cool. And Sam, thanks for hopping on, man. It was great. Great discussion. We really appreciate it. Fun times. So like I said, if you don't, thanks. If you don't, if you haven't, like the Discords are the best place. When we said we have two of them. You know, the Greyhawk events one's a little quiet, except for when it's Storm State. Thank you for the follow.
except when we're doing special events. But you can always find all the announcements and shout outs and stuff going on there. And then Cannon Fire Discord is good for discussion as well. It's a good place to go. And there may be some others that you find interesting too with Greyhawk as well. So, all right. Here is to eliminate confusion for this Saturday at noon Central, okay? If you are looking to sign up for something, pay attention, please, all right? Trying to help everyone out here. Thanks for the follow. Founders and Legends is completely sold out. All my games are sold out. Got it. Nothing we can do about that. They're sold out completely. Okay. So we'll get back to that in a second there, Curtis. Here is, now this is not up to date, but I'm going to go over all these. I have three RPG games, and I'm going to go over them banner-wise as well and explain them to you. But in the meantime, you have three great, and Anna's two. Anna, what time's your seminar?
Mine is on Friday at 11.
Friday 11 is Anna's,
yep.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So, in addition
plenty
to that...
Plenty of tickets left.
What's that?
Plenty of tickets left,
absolutely. Because more tickets are going to open up here. This is Jeremy at Gamescape 3Ds. 8 years of 3D printable terrain and OD&D-inspired design. Thursday at 4. Okay? That's the second seminar I'll have that day. First seminars, myself, Anna, and Greyhawk Mike. Legends of Lore Editions Change Greyhawk Indoors. Thursday at 2. Right after the game. We'll get to the games in a second. But the big one that is really selling like hotcakes... Don't wait on it. Legendary Maps of Forgotten Realms and Greyhawk with Ed Greenwood, Anna, and me. And that is at 4 o'clock Friday. All right? Big one. Now, here are the events. There's Jeremy. Hey, good to see you, Jeremy. Of course, man. Of course I'm going to shout you out because you're bringing so much of so much stuff for me to use. It's going to be awesome. All right. This is going to get you a chuckle. I received a message from someone. I don't want any. I have to do this. And he's like, Jay, I messed up. I didn't get all my stuff in. Can you do a bro a favor? I'm like, of course, for you, I can do anything. So here is a special announcement for Founders and Legends. For my 3 days, the Forgotten Temple of Tharizdun, with my good friends playing in the game, Todd Stashwick and Curtis Cable.
Ooh.
All right, playing in that, and Brett as well. It's all sold out, so we'll have as many as 8 players playing, but Todd is going to join us for this game. So there you go. I had to put my good friend in there to bust everyone's balls. And, of course, Curtis, my good friend, too. So yay for Curtis. Yes, Curtis and Brett are in all 3 days on that. So it's a 3-day event, 9 a.m. every morning, Saturday, Sunday, Monday. Okay? So there are no seats open for this. At all. It's completely sold out, and there's a ton of people on the wait list. So, hey, Gronk. All right, now, here's what's available starting, and you got to hit this right on the head, man. Puppets and then some. One seat will open up Saturday at noon Central. Okay? I know Scottish Jeff's in this. I know Kurt's in this. Who else is in this? Someone else in the community is in this, too. Savage Baron's in the game, and then another sign up. There's 4 signs. There's 1 open seat. You get to play with Little Bird and Coco. Cool, huh? Get to repeat that puppets, and then some. I'll have all my favorite puppets there for the fundraiser from last year. 1 seat opens up at noon. All right. I'm going to try and live stream this and the stuff at Founders and Legends. All the seminars will be streamed. It may be tough. To stream this one and the Founders and Legends game, just so you're aware. Yeah. That's why I put it if possible. Friday morning, 9 a.m., the Slav Squat Squad in Retaliation and Revenge. Eric Mona, Darling, Myriad, Bones, and Little Bird in this game. There's 1 open seat opening up at noon. 1. All right? 1 open seat opening up at noon. Got it? It's as good as I can do. All right? On that game. And lastly, this one already has it, and this one as well. 2 drink minimum in the lust for lost knowledge. We got Tony Winslow Brill, Anna Meyer, Chuck Combo, Bill Meinhardt, and of course Ed Greenwood playing Ravelantar in this game. So There's already 12 people on the wait list for it, but there's one seat opening up for it at noon as well. But good luck. That's all I can say is good luck to everyone for all their seats. You pick, you diplomatically pick which one of the three you want to try and get into, puppets or this, which or the Slav game. Okay, so that's it, and this will be streamed from the Chop House. It's so will the from the boardroom from the Slav game. They're definitely going to be streamed. Okay, just to show you what we got going on. Because it's coming up, and this will be it, and then I'll be completely sold out after these tickets open up on Saturday. Just want to let you all know. And that's the rules of the way it's set. So, all right. Yeah, the one at the Chop House in the boardroom, we had like, what, 10, 12 people watching the egg game last year, Anna, right, in the boardroom?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, the Chop House will be open,
jam-packed.
Too.
Jam-packed. Yeah, it was jam-packed in the room.
Yeah.
It was also freezing cold in there, so I'm glad it was the Chop House.
Because it just snowed. Yeah. Remember, it was snowing outside.
Yeah, yeah. Someone had the air conditioning still on or something. All right. It was terrible. Yeah.
So there you go. Here we go. We're going to do six giveaways. No, that's not right. Seven. All right. First two are going to be reprints, and then we'll go from there on the Virtual Greyhawk. Virtual Gary Khan, ethereal, and gift badges. All right. Here we go. Last call. You must got to tell me. The pile is growing, by the way, because Patrick stuff, like, multiplies. So, one way or another, it multiplies all over the place. So, oh, God, I almost got a hernia lifting it. White Plume. Tomb of the Lizard King, Ghost Tower, A Scarlet Butler Book, Shokanth, The Lost City, Veil of the Mage, A Treasures, Cult of the Reptile God, The Forest Oracle. Oh, God. there's a whole pile of stuff here. So, here we go. See who wins these. And yeah, lift. I should be doing a lot more than had Amy. It's age. And we'll see you tomorrow night at 7:30. Let me do these giveaways here. Did I hit a wrong button? Oh, yeah, I probably did. Oh, but I'm talking to myself, everyone. Giveaways. Here we go. Ready? Closing it out. Winner, Razkill. I think he's streaming now, so he's maybe not. You got it, Razkill. And the second winner, Lucitios. Here you go for the classic D&D reprints. Awesome. And Lucitios, if you're out of the country, are you the one out of the country? I can substitute some kind of gift certificate for it if you are. All right. Now, I'm gonna rapid shot these. And then if you say I'm going to Gary Khan already and you don't want an ethereal badge or a gift badge, I will get them to you. I will get them, you know, you can just pass on it. Here we go. BB Fan Fun, you get the ethereal. Keith Rogier, Gith, Deldawath. I think you just got one, didn't you? Didn't you get one last time? XT Candy, Tino M Boogers. Good. That's good to hear. It's a casualty. All right. So I'm going to go BB. I will either, if I don't have your Discord, I'm going to put them in right here in the chat with the codes. All right. And then we got BB. We got RoGR. I know he's got, I'll put that to you in. So these are all, so you can play in games. You can play in these games virtually. And like Lando will have games in it. There'll be a lot of people with games in it. Gith. Let me just make sure I got them all. Deldawath, XT Candy, M Boogers. XT Casualty. Got it. All right. XT Candy, M Boogers. Well, thank you all for a great show tonight.
Yeah, and thank you, Sam, for coming on.
Yeah, that was awesome.
Saving our bacon today. That was awesome.
Yes, absolutely.
Didn't think I had that much, but I'm glad.
Oh, you had
really
tons.
Bring stuff that you found useful.
Yep.
Of course.
Overall, I think it was a really good discussion tonight. I hope so. Yeah.
And just note that we want, if you can't participate in GaryCon in person, we want you to participate virtually. There's going to be a ton of games. Just sign up if you want to have fun. See how it goes, you know?
Yeah.
So
I'll tell you, I plan to run for my patrons. I'm going to do on my patron Discord, I'm going to show all the slides and do a special show before, and people can ask questions and stuff. And I will run after GaryCon, I will run on my Twitch. I will go over the slides and have it ask me anything and stuff like that. So several people have asked me if I'm going to stream my seminar. No, but you will get a chance. If you're a patron, you will get a chance before the convention to see the slides and stuff. And for everybody else, you can come on Twitch afterwards and I'll show you all the slides and go over 2 hours and stuff. You can ask questions and so on. So there will be a chance, even if you don't go to GaryCon, there will be a chance to see it afterwards too. And I will make the slides available on my website and the links and stuff, but you can also ask questions and stuff. So yeah.
All right, so we're going to read over to Heroes Zone. Why not? We'll change it up a little bit tonight. It's not going to hurt anything. Sam, thanks a lot. Everyone, we'll see you tomorrow night, 7:30, it's a Night of Ulic adventure. These characters are, you don't say like 10 fighter cleric or 10th level water elementalist. It's not hot, it's real high, or 10th level archer. Yeah, they're pretty powerful characters, and I'm going to put them through the ringer for the next 2 weeks. So just remember, no Legends of Lore next week. I'll be in Vegas. No game next Thursday. I'll be still in Vegas. So, I got 4 streams this week. Tonight, tomorrow night, Saturday morning, Sunday night. So we'll crank it out this week. So, all right, we'll see everyone.
Yep.
Everyone I'll have a great night.
Some more streams.
And I will fill in, yes.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Lucitios, I'm going to give you, I'm going to send you a cool adventure. I'm going to send you Lost City. I think you'll enjoy that. I'm going to send you this. This is a real good good old school one. That's what I'll send you. All right, everyone, see you soon. Curtis, hope your wife enjoyed that my good friend thing. That was pretty funny, huh? I set that banner up as a little bit of a joke there. What am I doing now? Stream manager, raid channel. We'll give him a shot. I never see what these new things drive me crazy, man. So it's like I can't see how many people are rating it. There it is. 65, 4, 3, 2, 1. We'll see you all tomorrow night. Awesome. Very cool. That was great.